people. He added, in the event of a storm of the city, the number of victims will increase by magnitude. We have no humanitarian corridors. There is no supply of medicines. Food supplies are nearing their end. Ukrainian officials have said they are ready to agree to a ceasefire, but only on the condition that the rebels surrender all their arms. FPP Radio News is brought to you by Coinbase. Coinbase is a simple and secure online Bitcoin wallet for sending, receiving, and storing Bitcoin. I trust Coinbase. You should too. Get started at coinbase.fppradio.com. That's coinbase.fppradio.com. Ballot Access News reports, for the first time since 1916, every statewide South Dakota state office has a minor party or independent candidate on the general election ballot. There is no minor party candidate for governor, lieutenant governor, U.S. Senate, or U.S. House, but there are independent candidates for all of those offices except for U.S. House. South Dakota makes it very difficult for a minor party member to get on his or her own party's primary ballot for statewide offices. The Socialist Party had a complete slate for all statewide offices in 1916. This has been FPP Radio News, online at fppradio.com.
House of Representatives Bill 323, the IHOP should stay open all night so we can get some pancakes act. This bill was submitted for immediate review very late last night under the provisions of the National Emergency Legislation Act.
Can we dim the lights? It's really bright.
H.R. 323 would, by federal order, require all IHOP restaurants to, quote, remain open 24 hours effective right this minute, even if some manager has to get out of bed and drive down here to start making some pancakes.
Well, we stand by the bill.
Right. We wrote it, apparently.
This bill would also require the federal government pay to build a tram or monorail or whatever connecting the Black Sheep Pub on North Capitol Street to all IHOP restaurants
in the city.
I think
we made some illustrations of that.
The bill gives the estimated cost of the tram as probably not even that much. You are wasting my time and the time of this committee.
Excuse me, I gotta go.
What? Congressman, this committee is still in session. You can't...
This is the Onion News Network.
This is Free Talk Live. You're listening to the live Sunday night show. Yes, we're live. It's Sunday evening, and we're here doing a radio show for you. I know that's kind of unusual, but maybe you're used to it by now. We've been doing this for about 3 years, right, Mark?
Yep, the live Sunday edition on the radio, 3 years.
And, of course, it's me, Stephanie, here with you.
And Brian.
And Mark.
And you can call us. Free Talk Live is a show where you can basically bring up anything that's on your mind. That's another thing that makes us different from other radio shows. The number to do that, if you want to get in touch with us, is 855-450-3733.
And now that doesn't mean that Free Talk Live, we don't have opinions, right? Like, we've got opinions. And
of course we have opinions.
But they're different than the sort of the left-right Republican-Democrat opinions.
Yeah, I think we've had a bunch of new stations joining us recently because, of course, we're a nationally syndicated radio show. We pick up radio affiliates all the time.
I think we're on like 155 stations now.
Oh, that's awesome. Yeah. So there's been a lot of growth, especially for the Sunday show, which is Free Talk Live has been on the air for over, I think, 11 years now.
12 years.
Going on 12, maybe?
Going on 12,
it's
yeah.
2002,
you're right?
That's when
right.
It started. So, okay. So, Free Talk Live has been on the air for quite a while now, but the Sunday show is the most recent addition. It was just added in, 2011 or something like that? Summer of 2011.
You'd know better than I.
So, basically, there's been a lot of growth in the Sunday show in particular. So,
because there's not much competition for live radio on Sundays.
Well, hey, there's a market opportunity. We had to fill it. But if you're hearing something different than you're used to on the radio, don't be surprised by that. If you have questions, we're happy to talk to you about anything that you hear on the show at 855-450-3733. Or you can bring up anything that's on your mind. We've actually got a call on Skype here. We've got Jimmy on the line. Hey, Jimmy, you're on Free Talk Live.
Push the CPU button?
Yeah. Hey, Jimmy, can you hear us? Jimmy, going once.
Sometimes it's the sound card.
All right. Well, Jimmy, we're going to put you on hold, and we'll try you again in just a few minutes here. Sorry about that, if that's our fault. Anyway, we were going to talk tonight about something that I think a lot of people may have heard of, because it's just one of those cute
memes that keeps going around. But there's actually a quite a serious issue in there about property and sort of ownership of property that's not physical. It's or maybe intellectual property.
Yeah, that's what they call it. Sure.
And this is about the monkey selfie.
The monkey selfie. Yes.
Yeah, you've got the story, right, Brian? Tell us more about that.
Yeah, this isn't what you expect when you hear monkey selfie, right? Like you go to the zoo, you see a monkey selfie. Not the same thing.
No.
So a selfie is a picture that you take of yourself, right?
Right.
That's right.
And so there's been a macaque monkey, right?
Is macaque? That what you say? Macaque?
Rhesus? I say rhesus monkey because rhesus macaque is the name.
You're the doctor. I don't know. So that's a rhesus monkey?
I think so.
Okay.
Yeah,
how many of those have you killed?
None.
Okay. Because you've slewn in your thousands of rats, right?
Mice, not mice, rats. Okay. I don't think I've ever killed a rat, but a mice, definitely,
Slain. You've slain in your thousands.
There's been a monkey that's taken a picture of itself. And it's quite a cute picture. It's actually a very good picture, you know. The monkey is smiling.
Yeah, it smiled, you know, and it has a nice grin to it.
If you've seen this picture, you probably will remember it because it's very memorable.
It's a good picture. Yeah.
It's a really good picture. So what's the issue with this?
It's completely lacking in inhibitions, right? Like he's just giving it a big old grin.
Yeah. So, the story comes from Gizmodo that I'm reading by Ashley Feinberg, and it's Wikimedia, and of course, Wikimedia is the parent company of Wikipedia, won't take down this photo because a monkey took it. Time and time again, British nature photographer David Slater has asked the editors of Wikipedia to stop using his photos without permission. Unfortunately for Slater, at least in the eyes of the Wikimedia Foundation, they're not quite his photos because the monkey pressed the shutter. Slater, or depending on where your loyalties lie, the self-loving primate, took the photo.
You did it.
took the photo all the way back in Indonesia in 2011 after Slater finished setting up his camera in hopes of capturing a crested black macaque. Is that how we did it?
Macaque.
Okay. A particularly curious member of the species sidled up and proceeded to take hundreds of selfies. Hundreds. So there's like just one, but this guy, it's tough not to call him a guy when he's taking pictures of himself,
he's
right?
Prolific.
Yeah. And let's see, as Slater explained to the Telegraph,
perhaps.
Yeah. They were quite mischievous, jumping all over my equipment, and it looked like they were already posing for the camera when one hit the button. The sound got his attention, and he kept pressing it. At first, it scared the rest of them away, but they soon came back. It was amazing
to
watch.
It's like group selfies, you know? Yeah.
Hey, guys, let's take a serious one now. Let's take a silly one now.
Okay, now make your weirdest face.
Yeah. He must have taken hundreds of pictures by the time I got my camera back, but not very many were in focus. He obviously hadn't worked that out yet.
Yeah.
One thing Slater didn't bargain for, though, is the fact that the photo's unusual origins make it fair game for free use in Wikimedia Commons eyes. According to a recent transparency report, all of Slater's removal requests have been denied because technically, since the monkey took it, nobody owns the copyright at all.
According to Wikimedia.
Right.
Right. That is their claim.
Yeah, there's no Supreme Court decision on this, right?
And I think that this is fascinating because it really sort of brings up that question of ownership when it comes to intellectual property. We've had people who are photographers and songwriters call this show, and we generally take on this show, generally take the tack that intellectual property does not exist, and that, or if it does exist, that sharing isn't stealing.
So, yeah, we've also had Stefan Kinsella on the show, who's one of the most famous voices against IP, and he's actually an IP attorney, so there's that too.
Indeed. So in this case, now it was, what's the photographer's name?
Slater, David Slater. Slater.
It's Slater's equipment, but the monkey presses the button.
And so, wait a minute, why does he want the images taken down? Is he claiming that they're his and he wants to control them and sell them to newspapers and stuff like that?
Yeah. Yeah, pretty much. He's claiming IP. There's been $17,000 in legal fees that he's already been paying out, and he's trying to resolve all of this.
Wow, that sounds so silly. I mean, because the image is out there now, right? It's already been released to the
world.
There's
no getting it back.
Yeah.
But this is what intellectual property is about. I'm going to put something on the internet. I'm going to let you look at it. But if you try to use it, whammo bammo, I'm going to get you with the lawsuit, and you're going to pay 10 times what it's worth because we got to feed the lawyers' families, too.
It's just an old business model. You know, like, there are lots of creative people on the internet who find ways to make money from their work that don't involve like restricting the use of images or podcasts or whatever. I mean, Free Talk Live, we are practicing what we preach on this, because we actually give away our podcast for free, and we say, hey, you can use it, you can remix it, you can chop it up, and in fact, someone does that. There's a weekly digest of Free Talk Live that has excerpts from all seven nights of the week, and it sort of gives a weekly summary. But if our podcast was...
You can go to digest.freetalklive.com and get that if you don't want to listen to all... I guess with the podcast, it comes out to something like 14 hours a week of Free Talk Live, but that's still a lot of podcast to consume. Yeah.
Yeah, that's kindly put together by Benjamin Bartholomew there.
Yep. Yeah.
But he wouldn't be able to do that if we had sort of locked down and copyrighted our podcast and said, no, no, you can't do anything. You can't make any derivative works without asking our permission or whatever.
Well, I think they're getting into some really serious areas here. There's a couple interesting points to the story, but one of them is that now, if this was the age of the Polaroid or of the film, you know, of film, you know, you would have to take film to get it developed or whatever. I think it might end up being a very different story. Now, I don't agree with IP at all. But in that case, you have something that, you know, you would, to some degree, have genuine, like, control over, I think you could say, where that film goes, where that Polaroid goes, whatever the case may be. But the digital world, you know, IP didn't have any, you know, the ideas of intellectual property had no understanding of the digital realm and how that works, because this really should go a lot farther.
Yeah.
Because how many people's pictures, including Slater's, I'm sure, because a lot of cameras, your DSLR cameras, all of them are connected to the internet now, even if he's out in the middle of nowhere, yeah. I wouldn't be shocked.
The NSA has all our pictures.
Sure, the NSA or Google, everything gets backed up to the cloud, so then it's on those servers. Should Google be paying you for holding your pictures? Now, yeah, you can say you use the terms of service that does that, but hold on. Then, yeah, I mean, where does this go? Where does this end?
Your copyright. I mean, the whole thing gets really silly. You know,
yeah,
they're really archaic laws.
Are you familiar with these wildlife cameras that hunters will use and just people in general?
Yeah.
That, you know, you like strap them to the side of a tree and they take pictures when something moves in front of them.
Right.
Who owns that?
Yeah, that's a motion sensor, so nobody pressed the button.
Does
in
the
that
computer,
case.
Does the little gizmo own its own pictures?
And what about the moose's privacy?
Indeed, the moose. It's been violated.
855 450 free here on Free Talk Live. Can a monkey own a selfie that it takes? What do you think? 855 450 free. More coming up.
In a far future universe, Earth's fleet is shattered, rife with guerrilla warfare, interspecies diplomacy, and full-scale interstellar combat. Humanity is about to face its trial by fire. Trial by Fire, Book 2 in the Tales of the Terran Republic, sequel to the national best-selling and award-winning Fire with Fire, by distinguished professor and author Charles Gannon. Get it now from Amazon through shop.freetalklive.com.
Are you searching for your soulmate? Someone you can trust, who will never betray you, or cooperate with the NSA? Stop searching. With EasyDNS, you found a keeper. EasyDNS does it all. Domain names, web hosting, and managed WordPress hosting. EasyDNS stands up for your internet freedom. And with servers in Canada, they do not cooperate with the NSA. Go to EasyDNS.com. You'll love their services or get a full refund. They guarantee it. And they accept Bitcoin. That's EasyDNS.com.
Adam Miller here with Midas Resources. Today, August 8th, 2014, gold opened at $13,13.40. A 1 ounce gold coin can be purchased for $13.60.104, $6.80.52 for half ounce, or $3.40.26 for quarter ounce. That's $13.60.104, $6.80.52, and $3.40.26.
Hi, this is Ted Anderson. Have you ever wondered why banks, stockbrokers, investment advisors won't talk about gold IRAs? Wait a sec. Gold and silver is going up while Congress is trying to settle on the next debt increase. And there's no end to this madness. That old 401k and IRA can be converted into physical gold without tax consequences. I explained this in my book, 10 Reasons to Buy Gold. Don't let time slip away. Call for your free copy today, 800-686-2237. Get away from that Washington spin and get honest answers about gold. 800-686-2237. The book is free, 800-686-2237.
Hi, I'm Derek J. I don't want a politician to represent me. To me, government is the idea that one group of people can coerce everyone to comply with an edict or face increasing punishments up to and including death. Despite perhaps the most noble of intentions, the best government services are a far cry from what could be provided for by voluntary interactions. Besides, the people who call themselves the government wage wars and put peaceful people in jail for crimes involving no victims. If Starbucks used some of its money to drop bombs, I wouldn't shop there. So why would I support the American Empire? The Empire does not require my consent.
Derek J's Victimless Crime Spree. Watch it for free and order the Director's Cut DVD at victimlesscrimespree.com. That's victimlesscrimespree.com.
If you want to know the latest about Free Talk Live before we go on the air, all you need to decide is how you want it delivered. It's your choice. Visit news.freetalklive.com. You can get emailed announcements and participate in contests via our email updates list. Plus, we have a Twitter account that you can follow and a Facebook page where you can become a fan. So visit news.freetalklive.com to get news about Free Talk Live as soon as it's announced and the way you want it delivered at news.freetalklive.com. That's news.freetalklive.com.
Hi, this is Michael Dean from the Freedom Fiends Radio Show. The internet has lowered the cost barrier for a worldwide radio show to a price approaching zero. Yet there is one arena where you still need thousands of dollars to approach the audio quality of the corporate media. Doing a live spoken show with more than one host in different geographic locations. Our program, Fiend Phone, will solve that problem, and it will be given away free. Go to fiendphone.com to see what you can do to help. That's FEENPHONE.com.
If you enjoy LRN.FM, please contribute to your favorite shows via their websites and become an amplifier at amp.lrn.fm. That's amp.lrn.fm.
This is Free Talk Live. It's the live Sunday night show with me, Stephanie.
And Brian.
And Mark.
855-450-FREE is the number to call where you can bring up anything that's on your mind. We're talking about the monkey selfie, the infamous monkey who snapped a photo of itself. And now the photographer who owned the camera is mad and wants to assert some intellectual property over it. But can a monkey actually own a selfie, or does anyone own it, or does anyone own any pictures at all? That's what we'll be talking about in moments here.
Yeah, I was looking at the selfie here of the macaque, and I was noticing there's a little tartar on his teeth. And
it's her teeth, Mark.
Is it her?
It's a female. Yeah.
Well, I
all that explains everything. That's why it's taking pictures.
I would never mention it directly to her, because you know that would just not be appropriate. However, she could have dressed this with My Magic Mud. My Magic Mud is a remedy for your teeth that removes plaque and detoxifies the mouth of bacteria that cause cavities. Now, I have used My Magic Mud for a couple of months now. I used it every day for like 2 weeks. It probably wasn't that long, 10 days. And in the first application, I saw a difference in the stains on my teeth.
Yeah.
And in four applications, all the stains were removed.
Yeah, you know, I've actually been using it too. I heard the ads on Free Talk Live, and I actually went out and bought some because it just sounded so cool.
Well, I actually traded out for some ads for.
Oh, cool!
And I just gave you another jar, and
yeah,
like,
every one of our
co-hosts is going to get one because I love this stuff.
It's awesome.
No kidding, I am in love with this stuff.
Yeah, and so I'm happy to talk about my review of it. Like literally the first time I used it, I just noticed that it felt basically like after you go to get your teeth cleaned at the dentist and they polish your teeth.
Yeah.
They just feel so smooth, like they've been polished is the only way I can really describe it. And those who know me or see me on the camera at cam.freetalklive.com know
you have awesome teeth already.
Well, I was going to say I drink a lot of tea, which is known to kind of stain your teeth.
I see.
And I sort of tried to take a picture to see if they would look whiter, and I'm still kind of in process with that. We'll see if they actually look whiter. Maybe I'll publish my pics, but they definitely felt smoother, which is another thing with stains, where the stains make them feel kind of rough.
You can feel that sort of roughness, but the My Magic Mud removes that.
Yeah, it's made out of bentonite clay, which is, I actually researched this, it's a volcanic clay, and it's got minerals in it, but it has this property that when it gets hydrated, when it gets exposed to water, it gets some kind of electrical charge. So it actually clings to bacteria and to particles of food that are in your mouth, and it draws
them out. It clings
to
things, and that's what's in your mouth.
Exactly. Exactly. So it's actually a really good material for this purpose.
Don't take our word for it. Check out Dr. Griffin Cole and what he's got to say at mymagicmud.com. Mm-hmm. It's awesome stuff. I won't live without it any longer.
Yeah, totally.
Mymagicmud.com.
Cool. All right. Let's talk to Jimmy in Arizona on Skype. He was waiting patiently, had a little issue with his microphone. Jimmy, are you there?
Hello, Stephanie, Mark, Satan.
Hey, Jimmy. That's
actually my dad, Jimmy, but thank you.
I'm sorry. I get confused. Still learning. Hey, y'all seen that story? I saw it on Facebook. My wife, Milford, showed it to me. It was about some deaf people working at a restaurant. Y'all familiar with that?
No. What's the story about?
Well, it's real nice. It's like a restaurant, and everybody that works there, except for, I guess, the owner, they're all deaf. You have to use sign language to order your food. And,
oh, wow.
Yeah. It's interesting. They got little guides that show you how to do the different signs, and, you know, you order your, you know, appetizers and all that. And everything has to be in the right sign language.
Wow. Well, that's kind of like going to a Mexican restaurant and you have to order in Spanish or something, right?
Yeah. Similar to that. Yeah. Well, I got myself an idea for a business, and I'm thinking about starting up there in New Hampshire when me, Milford, Grammaton, and Jar Jar Jr. move up there.
Cool.
It's Milford's idea, and she's kind of the entrepreneur of the family, and she wants to open up a strip club with only deaf strippers. So, yeah, well, you know, you don't have to pretend to listen to what they're saying. It's pretty nice.
That's pretty funny.
I wasn't sure. I mean, what do y'all think of that? I mean, I figured it'd be a good idea, and it'd probably give a new meaning for the phrase hand job. I figured.
Wow. Yeah. Just make sure you.
I don't think this happened in strip clubs.
Yeah. Make sure you accept Bitcoin. You know, you're gonna have to figure out a way to do that.
I think sadly most men are more interested not in them being deaf but in being mute. You know, the strippers. So.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, they're deaf people, but I'm sure they're still going to college, so they probably still want to talk to people.
Yep. They're stripping their way through college. Hey, has Milford ever? Why is she interested in this kind of business? Does she have, a past as a stripper or anything like that? Does she have experience?
Oh, yeah. She won state back at Texas. Best stripper.
Nice.
State.
Wow, state gold. She won.
Well, it was a high school event, you know.
Jimmy, thanks for the call tonight. I can't wait to see your business working out here in New Hampshire.
Yeah. You know, he does bring up one of the more interesting lack of freedoms, actually, in New Hampshire. And that is that I think you can have topless, but you can't have bottomless in a business.
That may very well be true. In Sarasota, Florida, there was a place called The Cheetah. I believe it's called The
Cheetah. Florida's got some really funny laws about this stuff.
Yeah, you can have it, but you can't serve sort of drink. I don't know. They've got a bunch of different rules, and they were full on naked there. And like, I don't need it, you know, into one of these things. I guess it's a freedom I don't miss, I guess is what I'm trying to say. Mm-hmm.
You could get a private strip lap dance anytime you want, right?
I don't know about that. I'd probably have to wash the dishes and, like, put them away and vacuum.
Small price to pay.
Yeah.
Let's talk to Alexander listening in Louisiana. Hey, Alexander, you're on Free Talk Live. What's on your mind?
I'm calling about a mean Texas lawyer. I'm wondering if you guys heard about him. He was suing the Tor Project because of pink meth.
Because of pink meth? What's that?
It's a revenge porn site where people go and post nudes after they break up, toast it on the Onion router and whatnot. Mm. So this guy thought he could sue Tor to get the information. And I'm sure you guys know already it's decentralized and whatnot. And
yeah.
Tor has no real control over that.
Yeah, Tor is a nonprofit organization, as I understand it, right?
Yes.
Like right. Mozilla, basically?
Yeah, it's 501, yeah.
Yeah. So the lawyer, the problem that he has is that there's a revenge porn site on Tor. Aren't there other things on Tor, like, that maybe he'd object to also? Or why is he going after that specific site?
He's going after that specific site. I've had a few conversations with him because he's suing me now, and I'll get to that in a second.
Whoa.
I had a few conversations with him because he's suing the site for a friend. Basically, some of her stuff is up there.
But Tor's not a site, right?
Yeah, he wanted to. Originally, Pink Meth had both sites. They had pinkmeth.com or something, I believe, and they got pushed into, you know, Tor because it was on the regular surface web, and they got a lot of heat for it, obviously.
Right.
So now the guy is trying to get a default judgment on them and to try and get their identities. He thought he could go after Tor.
Okay.
Basically, because he was an idiot, I went and rated him one star on Facebook and said, terrible service. And he offered $200 for my docs. And I knew my docs was on the internet already, so I went ahead and gave him the
Alexander, gave him my if you could hold the line, I'd really like to hear more about this. Hold on a second. We'll talk to you more about the lawyer who's suing Tor and suing Alexander, who's on the line with us.
This is crazy.
Very interesting stuff. And monkey selfies, too. Coming up here on Free Talk Live, 855-450-FREE for your thoughts.
It's the heart of summer across America. Thoughts turn to childhood and long days of fun. Everybody would love to feel like a kid again. An HB extract can be a vital tool in your battle to stay vibrant and young, as it supports healthy blood pressure and circulation while balancing cholesterol. GCN and longtime sponsor HB extract want to help keep your heart healthy with the 30 bottles, 30 days summer giveaway. Enter to win by visiting GCNlive.com between now and August 29th and click on the contest banner in the top left corner of the page. HB Extract has helped tens of thousands of people worldwide feel good again, and they've done it with HB Extract's exclusive formula of wild-crafted and organic herbs. Here's to you enjoying many more long, warm, and fun-filled summers, free of pain and sickness. Visit GCNlive.com and enter to win in the 30-bottle, 30-day summer giveaway with HB Extract. A healthy heart is a happy heart. Sign up now at GCNlive.com.
Anyone can publish on the internet, but not everyone is publishing material suited for online reading. According to the Yahoo Style Guide, it cautions that internet content has a few seconds, three or less, to encourage people to read more, to take action, or navigate to another one of your pages. So make it easy for readers to pick and choose. Isn't that the way you poke around online? Use short words, short sentences, short paragraphs, bulleted lists, and short pages. Front load what you write, putting the most important information at the beginning of headlines and paragraphs and sentences. Same goes for your keywords. What someone would likely type into the search box on Yahoo or Google. For more tips on communicating better online or in a job interview or everyday life, hit survivalspeech.com. I'm Holland Cook.
Did you know that Free Aid is a mutual aid, educational, and networking organization? At Free Aid, we support volunteers who provide first aid. We do outreach to the public about health and safety, and we bring together medically skilled freedom lovers. Free Aid is made possible by your generous support. Donors can receive great gifts like first aid kits, t-shirts, silver dime cards, and hoodies. The Free Aid Silver Dime Card Project is sponsored in part by Roberts & Roberts Brokerage, Freedom's Phoenix, and Don't Tread on Meme. Visit fr33aid.com.
Here's a chance to do a little activism while you're cruising Facebook, Twitter, or Google+. Between the LOL cats, the recipes, the hot girls, and the inspirational sunrise memes, Free Talk Live's posts pass by your newsfeed. Like them. Comment. It gives us more exposure. If you don't see our posts, click like at facebook.freetalklive.com and then hover over it to click get notifications. It's an easy way to spread the ideas of liberty a bit further. I know you're busy, but you can spare that tenth of a calorie it takes to click on something. Facebook.freetalklive.com.
Free Talk Live.
People, they like to complain about the idea that the money is taxpayer dollars. It's not really true, is it? I mean, they were your dollars until you gave them to the government.
Right.
Now they're their dollars, and they're going to do whatever the hell they damn well want to do with them.
You're right.
It is still your money in that if a thief comes and steals money from you,
it doesn't cease to be yours just because they stole it.
You still have a claim on that, but you don't have the ability to control the thief unless you actually have him in your custody.
Mm.
So that thief is going to go out and buy a big screen TV or do whatever, you know, spend it on coke and whores or whatever it is that thieves do with the money that they steal. And
that's what the politicians do with it.
Yeah, you know, you can call the thief on the phone and say, I told you not to spend that money on whores. And he's going to say, well, thanks for the input.
Yeah,
noted.
I appreciate that.
Free Talk Live, 7 nights a week from 7 to 10 Eastern, live on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM. You can put the Liberty Radio Network on the air in your area. Visit broadcast.LRN.FM to learn how. Broadcast.LRN.FM.
This is Free Talk Live, the live Sunday night show. It's me, Stephanie, here.
And Brian.
And Mark.
And 855-450-FREE is the number to call if you want to bring up anything that's on your mind. We are talking to Alexander, who's being sued by a lawyer who's also suing the tour project. Very interesting stuff. Want to get back to him in just a moment. But first,
when you're looking to get cosmetic surgery, it can be kind of a scary thing. There's, you know, where do you go?
Any surgery, yeah.
Well, surgery, yes. But I mean, when it comes to cosmetic surgery, you know, I don't think it's difficult to find out where the good places are and where, you know, of course, expense is a real issue.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, we've been talking about AsiaRunLikeHellGuide.com here on Free Talk Live. You can go to Bangkok to this hospital that serves over 300,000 patients a year from 40 countries. They've got 300 doctors, surgeons, dentists right in the same hospital. And they really do. They do a huge business in people who do the medical tourism. And one of the areas they really specialize is in cosmetic surgery. So
now, what are we talking about here? Could it be something like LASIK eye surgery or something?
I don't
like
know if they specifically do LASIK. You'd have to go to the website, AsiaRunLikeHellGuide.com, to be
what
able
about,
to answer
like,
that.
If someone's transgender and they want to change?
They do a lot of sexual reassignment, but they, mm-hmm. you know, most of their stuff is breast augmentations, you know, things for porn stars and the like. So, you know, liposuction, that kind mm-hmm. of thing. But, you know, I mean, they do an awesome job at it. And as a matter of fact, if you don't want to sit in the waiting room while your spouse is there, because you can go, this is awesome. You're going to Bangkok. You can get your yeah. surgery done. You can hang out there, get better, and then go home and look like $1 million. Golf courses all over the place. Bangkok truly is a metropolitan area. You're going to love it. Go check them out. AsiaRunLikeHellGuide.com. It's fractions of the cost of U.S. prices.
Yeah, that's so important. You know, as the medical system in the U.S. just gets more and more screwed up by the day. And trust me, I know, because I went to medical school for a couple of years and I chose not to continue.
Right,
and
one exactly of the reasons, for this reason.
Yeah, is that it's just getting so messed up by Obamacare and everything else. Medical tourism is huge and it's going to be even bigger.
Yep. Access to the latest techniques and surgeons with thousands of previous surgeries equal the best possible outcomes. So it's AsiaRunLikeHellGuide.com. This is now Glenn, the guy who runs the website, he's essentially a broker. He's your intermediary in dealing with the hospital. He's an expert in dealing with them, but he's going to help you. So you don't have to talk to somebody who may have not have the entire command of the English language. He's going to be very helpful. AsiaRunLikeHellGuide.com.
Cool. All right. 855-450-FREE here on the Sunday edition of Free Talk Live. You can also call in on Skype by Skyping LRN.FM. That's our Skype handle there. And of course, the phone lines are brought to you by ProXPN, our favorite VPN company here on Free Talk Live. Let's go right back to the phones and talk to Alexander. Now, Alexander, in case people are just tuning in, you were just saying in the last segment that there's a lawyer who's suing the Tor project. Tor is a software. It's a web browser that allows you to go to certain websites anonymously on a different sort of internet that you can only access through Tor. And there was a revenge porn site on there, and the lawyer is suing the Tor project, which doesn't run this website, in order to get the name of the person who does run the website, I guess.
And this is kind of like suing ICANN because there's something on the internet.
It's like suing Firefox because there's you know, a website that you don't like on the internet.
Yeah.
It's kind of ridiculous. But you said he's also suing you because you gave him a 1-star rating on his Facebook page because you didn't like what he was doing with the Tor project. And that's, I think that's where we left off.
Right. He went ahead and told me that if I didn't take it down in 12 hours, that he would sue me and he'd pay somebody $200 for my address. I knew that my address was already online and I didn't want somebody else claiming this bounty on my head. So I messaged him my address from my girlfriend's account and I went ahead and got the $200 from this guy. It's in my PayPal account.
You're killing me.
Wow. Isn't that illegal, like what he did? Like, can you actually do that?
I'm not sure. I mean, I guess it's public information, and, you know, I'm an adult, so I don't really know.
But it was with the intent of basically harassing you, right? Like, that's what doxing is, when you post someone's address for the purposes of, like, trolling them, basically.
Right. Well, it was actually for what's called a slap suit, which is basically, you know, you're not really trying to get a judgment. You're just trying to silence somebody.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
This is the letter from the lawyer, essentially.
Okay. So dirty tactics, nonetheless. So what happened after that?
I told him to get, I can't say my exact words for, on the air reasons, but.
I love that you got the $200.
Yeah, I told him to go ahead with himself and go ahead and sue me. I called him on his bluff. Turned out he wasn't bluffing, and he did file in small claims court over in Texas. And I
for what? For giving him a bad rating on his Facebook page?
Well, yeah, I kind of missed something there because we went into something else. But basically, I told a forum I go to about the $200 because I thought it was hilarious, him paying me for my address.
Mm-hmm.
I stepped outside to smoke and I came back and the forum had pretty much gone crazy with it. They started doxing him. They went to 4chan with it. They ended up doing an old-fashioned raid and sending him pizza and whatnot,
Wow.
And I have archives of everything to prove that I never once called for any of this stuff, that I was just, sitting back and watching them do their little thing. I have all my proof and everything, but, I still have to go over and fight it.
In small claims court in Texas.
Yeah, there's not even jurisdiction for me to go out there.
Yeah, I wonder about this. How can they hold you to this? I mean, whoa. Why don't we talk about my court? Because he can just claim whatever he wants, wherever he wants.
Yeah, and you live in Louisiana, right? You're not even in Texas.
You're lucky you don't live in Seattle.
That's why I brought up anti-slap laws, because he pretty much admitted to me in a private message whenever I tried to contact him after I got the paperwork in the subpoena. I tried to message him and say, look, you're a big gun rights guy. You have, your licensing for specific firearms, and you're calling for the licensing of the internet. And this would be like me suing Glock. What you were doing would be like me suing Glock because you went and murdered somebody with your handgun. It's ridiculous, and that's why I raided. He ended up dropping the lawsuit on tour whenever, their guys came to him and told him what was on the up with that. And that was about a week ago, but he has not since dropped my lawsuit. He told me that I had to stop talking about him online or else he would not drop the lawsuit.
Wow.
So basically, that's why I brought up anti-slap laws. I just don't have the means of pursuing it. Thought it was a funny, interesting topic.
So he's basically saying you're not allowed to talk about him online is what the stipulation
that's
is?
Just sounds
are you allowed
like...
to talk about him on the radio? Because I just need you to understand that this conversation is copyrighted. It's under all IP laws in the state of New Hampshire, and that we own everything.
I can't really give a shit.
Sorry, we got to dump you, Alexander. But I appreciate the call. I mean, that was a really interesting story. Alexander, if you're still listening, sorry, we just can't air those words on the radio. But please keep
us
updated.
There's 4 words you can't say on Free Talk Live.
Yeah, please keep us updated on this case.
I am interested, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's actually a really interesting scenario. I mean, God, it just sounds like, lawyers can get away with a lot because they know the system and they know how to work within the system.
Yeah, they may know that system, but clearly they don't know the internet system. They don't know Tor because Tor is actually, because a lot of people have this concern about, see these dark, evil websites, they go run to Tor. Anything can get put on the internet, literally anything. The real key now that everybody, including like the EU with Google, are going after is, can you find it? Can you search for it? And generally, actually, Tor is really good about this, to where child porn sites, etc., you can't find them. Sure, they're there, but no one can really take them down. A lot of these groups, like the Hidden Wiki and some other websites, make sure you can never find these things. And I think that if that lawyer had any sense, or the person that he was doing it for, went and asked somebody at Pink Mesh or whatever, saying, hey, could you please take this down? I bet they would have done it.
Yeah.
Because there's just that respect that exists. Instantaneously, it seems, especially on Tor.
Yeah, there is. Absolutely. 855-450-3733 is our number here on Free Talk Live. Policing the internet. Doesn't know the 4chan system.
Never works.
This is Free Talk Live, and there's more coming up. Your thoughts, too.
Crashed.
The Death of the Dollar. It's a hot new novel that has a lot of people talking. It explores what our government's reaction to a U.S. currency collapse would be. And when the government nationalizes all supply chains in an effort to keep order, the sentiment voiced towards such a tyranny is, we're not picking the fight. The government already did that. We'll just be fighting back for a change. This is a great book, but don't take my word for it. Look at the reviews on Amazon. Bernie says, Crashed is a really terrifying trip. It is thought-provoking. It makes you wonder, what if? Could this happen? Gary Jones adds, This is an excellent book. It is also a little scary because it could very well be true. I hope it's fiction, and Julia Moffat calls it a gripping read and the most exciting, insightful book this year. Crashed is a fast-paced read that has two-thirds of its Amazon reviewers calling for a sequel. This book is totally worth your time. It's well-researched, liberty-oriented, realistic, gripping, and gritty. Do yourself a favor and don't miss this one. Get your copy at Amazon. Crashed, The Death of the Dollar by William Cooper.
If you need to say happy birthday, happy anniversary, thank you, or simply I'm thinking of you, ProFlowers.com is the key. ProFlowers has stunning bouquets, like the best-selling 100 blooms for $19.99. Plus, ProFlowers will include a glass vase for free. Sending someone a wonderful surprise of beautiful flowers sent fresh from the field is easy. Choose the bouquet you like, pick the delivery date, and each order is 100% guaranteed. Plus, all bouquets from ProFlowers are guaranteed to last at least 7 full days. Beautiful, fragrant flowers, picked fresh and sent to your loved one for lasting enjoyment. To get this incredible savings and send someone 100 gorgeous blooms with a free vase for $19.99, go to ProFlowers.com. Click the blue microphone in the top right corner and enter code PLOW. That's ProFlowers.com. Click the mic and enter code PLOW.
Did you agree? Did you totally agree? I'll bet that you did. But did you read the agreement? There are 7 billion people on Earth, and there are over 6 billion active cell phone accounts right now. And every one of them came with an agreement. Billions have already agreed to allow entities that they do not know to use and abuse every feature of their mobile devices. Your computer activity is monitored and archived. Your car is tracked, and even your face is scanned. The current power structure grows more fearful every day of your desire for anonymity, independence, free association, freedom of movement, freedom of expression, and your freedom of thought. And entire categories of humans will be targeted. And if they, then those that won't leave us alone, determine that we are not within their control, then we will be categorized as out of control. FreedomsPhoenix.com will launch the next phase of the Levolution by the end of the summer of 2014. And if you have to tell your neighbors about it, then we did it wrong.
So you've heard all 3 hours of the latest episode of Free Talk Live, and you're still hungry for liberty-oriented audio content? Did you know that we have another 24/7 audio stream at LRN.fm? The Liberty Radio Network airs the latest episodes of some of the best liberty-oriented podcasts on the internet around the clock. In addition to recorded content, you'll also hear live shows like Free Talk Live originating from our Keene, New Hampshire studio. So listen anytime at LRN.fm. That's LRN.fm.
This is Mark of Free Talk Live. We've been witnessing a meltdown of the economic engine that powers our country. With a printing press tethered to Washington bureaucrats and New York central bankers, how can we trust paper money? For years, I've been buying gold and silver from Midas Resources, and you should too. Call 877-357-9938 for a free book titled 10 Reasons to Own Gold, or go to gold.freetalklive.com. Again, 877-357-9938. 877-357-9938.
You can connect with the Liberty Radio Network via our Facebook page at facebook.lrn.fm. That's facebook.lrn.fm.
(855) 450-3733 is our number here on the Sunday show of Free Talk Live. Phone lines, of course, brought to you by ProXPN, our favorite VPN provider. You can also call us on Skype at lrn.fm and bring up anything that's on your mind. I think we're going to continue talking about this monkey selfie issue and the intellectual property thing. Was there more on that article, Brian, or did you just want to launch into the discussion?
There wasn't really anything more other than that he was, paying out. He's already paid out $17,000. David Slater, the the photographer who is having the issue here.
So David Slater, he goes out to take pictures of macaques or Rhesus monkeys.
Yeah, we're recapping here? I think that's a good idea.
And he essentially, he's got his equipment out, and then he gets kind of swarmed by little happy monkeys. And by the way, I would be petrified, right? Like, I'd pee, and then, you know, like, then decide what to do at that point. Because I would be afraid that they bite me. And, you know, I'm out there in the jungle, rabies, I'm not sure. Yeah. Do I make it back to camp?
They're curious. You don't know if they're hungry. They're going to
want
to...
Who knows what they want? So anyway, one of them manages to get the camera, starts pushing the button. It makes whirring noises. Scares all the other monkeys away, but he keeps taking pictures. He takes, apparently, literally... hundreds?
At
least 100 pictures of himself. And one of them is really great. We're looking here at a picture of him, and, you know, he's smiling unabashedly into the camera.
That's one of the aspects of this, is that it looks very human-like, you know? And say taking a picture of yourself is something that we think of as a very human action, or a human-like action. And I think
they even call animals, to some extent, especially specifically apes, they call them non-human persons.
Yeah.
So apes, dolphins, and a variety of other sort of intelligent beings they call non-human persons is what's sort of working its way through the legal system today.
Yeah.
And I suspect it will at some point go.
Well, in India, dolphins are already non-human persons. And
right.
The UN is working a new chapter, I think they call it, through to talk about, some of these various animals being that. And I'm open to that, actually.
Yeah, I mean, monkeys can recognize themselves in the mirror. And so there's a test for self-awareness among animals where basically the researchers will draw a little dot or something on the animal's forehead and then put a mirror in front of them and see if they try to rub their forehead to get the dot off, because that means they know that they're looking at themselves
in the mirror and
not at another animal.
A dotted monkey.
Yeah.
Right.
Some other monkey that has a dot on its head.
But
so you could imagine that the monkey might have some degree of awareness about that. Like, it might know that it was taking a picture of itself if it could see the preview of the picture, you know, in the camera.
I mean, I think Wikimedia is doing the right thing in saying that nobody owns this shot. Like, I agree with that assessment. And because I don't think there's any argument that the monkey owns it. And the reason I say that is that by Slater's description, the monkeys were just, they seemed to be not obsessed with the camera, but with the clicks. They were obsessed with the sound of what it was making. And I can understand that, because I do have a hard time, as much as I am open to various animals like elephants and whoever else and dolphins being non-human persons and having a degree of complexity to their, you know, to their mentality. I just can't believe they knew what they were doing. That it was a camera.
So then does that mean that if you have a camera automatically taking pictures every so often, but there's no human that's actually pressing the button, that nobody owns those pictures?
I think that's interesting. So if you time a camera and tell it to take pictures every 15 minutes, it could be argued that you took the picture because you set it. However, I think these wildlife cameras are very interesting. So you set up a camera on the side of a tree, you strap it down, you turn it on, and then it takes pictures when something goes by. And I think that, therefore, you aren't taking the picture, it's taking the picture itself.
Yeah,
and
I mean...
Do we think that do you think artificial intelligence is going to exist in the future? And if so, what's that look like? Because at this point, the camera appears to be taking pictures when something goes by.
Yeah, so does the camera have it? I mean, the thing is, this is all under the paradigm of intellectual property
as which is
defined
already
by the state.
Nonsense.
Yeah, which is total nonsense. And examples like this really illustrate how absurd it can get when you're talking about, well, who owns this picture? Is it the monkey, or is it the camera, or is it the man? You know, and like, why don't we just say that images are a type of thing that, you can put on the internet. They're concrete. They exist, but they can be copied indefinitely. And so copying those images is not stealing. You're not depriving anybody of the picture.
Right. Photographers are moving into a realm where people are going to ask for specific pictures of specific things. Businesses will want pictures of their products. They may want pictures of certain areas or something like that. People are always going to be interested in wildlife pictures where you caught the critter doing the amazing thing, whatever that thing was.
Yeah, animals are fascinating.
People are going to want pictures of their families. But, for instance, when you get the picture of your family, it says proof in big letters across it. I think at that point you've taken the steps to protect your intellectual property.
Well, yeah, that's exactly it. Sometimes when I send auditions for voiceover jobs, because I'm a voice actor, and so sometimes I send audition samples for free, basically, to the client. But if it's a really short job, if it's just a few words or one line, what do you do to prevent them? What's to prevent them from just using your audition?
I don't know. What do you do?
Well, you can watermark it. I usually don't, but you can. And some voice actors do. Watermarking is like when you put proof over a photo in kind of transparent letters. It makes it so that it's unusable for the finished product, but they can still get an idea of what it sounds like or looks like.
Yeah.
So what do you do to it to watermark it, though?
So in a watermark in an audio file, usually in the background, it would be like a soft voice saying like Stephanie Murphy or something like that.
I see.
Or music in the background or something like that.
Okay.
Yeah. And this is getting solved. Online, there's various websites that what they do now is they give you the opportunity to pay the talent and not for the product. Because, how do you charge for something that gets infinitely copied? I mean, part of the spirit of IP was protecting scarcity.
Are you talking about that website?
There's a few of them out there.
Yeah. So there are some websites that basically you can kind of amass a following and you'll get you as an artist or a podcaster or whatever.
Whatever it may be for.
We'll get like $1 from every fan every time you release a new song or a new podcast.
Right.
And so that's one way to kind of just leverage your reputation that you create by giving away stuff for free. And that's a creative way to sort of make money without having to lock down your product and sort of go after your customers with the legal system to try to get them to give you money, which is a very adversarial kind of relationship.
And a miserable way to live.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? Like if you're
who wants to police that, you know?
There's this one woman who created some poem that people seem to like on the internet, and basically if she finds it on your website, she goes and harasses you for money.
Oh my God,
and
seriously.
I mean, so now what we have is we have a poet who isn't out producing poetry, but instead is out policing intellectual property.
Yep,
I think
really
this
sad.
Is just a realm of waste in our society.
Oh yeah,
the whole intellectual property IP troll.
Yeah,
totally.
And
the
this
world
is
has changed. You know, it's a different society now.
No, it is, and I think this is far superior to do it this way. Say there's an author, okay, a personal favorite author of mine, Harlan Ellison. I would love, he's not writing any more books. The guy's practically 80, you know, I mean, yeah, he's still putting out some stuff, but I would love to continue to pay him yearly for, you know, work that he did 50 years ago. And now you can do that without having to waste the paper or whatever to keep buying more and more copies. I mean, you could do it that way too, I guess. But really, I mean, forget just novels. Take whatever talent you're interested in. This gives you the opportunity to continually pay for something that changed your life, say, at one point. And that's why people buy things, right? Is to enhance their life a bit, you know, when it comes to art.
Yeah.
I think that that's a fact.
I think often the reason that people don't pay for things like digital goods, for instance, books or photos or art or poetry or whatever, is because there's just no easy way to buy it, you know?
Sure.
Like having to enter your credit card info for a small charge is like a big annoyance.
Bitcoins,
you know?
Are going to get so ubiquitous that you're going to be able to do these online tips where you can just throw a quarter or whatever in.
Yeah. Right.
But when you can have everybody who enjoyed just your internet post or your essay or your song or whatever toss a quarter at you, you're going to make a lot of money.
Yeah.
If Barbara Streisand, every time somebody enjoyed her music, or at least every few times somebody enjoyed their music, they could toss a quarter at her, she would be she is extraordinarily wealthy, but she would be just as wealthy as she is. So
yeah, but I mean, maybe she's very wealthy because she's been so successful, but how much money did she miss out on making because her record companies made that money instead of her? It went to them.
Also, I kind of wonder what the, you know, somebody who made a song a long time ago, the Happy Birthday song we thought up until recently was copyrighted.
Oh yeah, that got debunked, huh?
Got debunked. But let's just think of a song from way back that still has the oldest song currently that is copyrighted, whatever that is. Mm-hmm. I don't know what it is.
Mm-hmm.
Really, should the children of somebody who wrote a song never have to work again? Now, this is some waste in the marketplace, right? Like, you've got people who never have to get a job and never have to produce anything because daddy wrote the Happy Birthday song,
well,
or grandpappy or great grandpappy.
Maybe that would happen in a free market, but it's happening artificially now because of the state-enforced intellectual property laws.
If anybody supports intellectual property, and that's fine, but I want you to consider, you're not paying the guy who created the wheel every time you drive.
Yeah, give us a call if you do support it, and we'll have a discussion. 855-450-3733. This is Free Talk Live, the Sunday Show. More coming up.
Lots of things change in life. Here's one thing that hasn't. For over 20 years, Lumber Liquidators has been the home of unbelievable flooring deals. And right now, those deals are even better. Take your pick of gorgeous pre-finished hardwoods like cherry, oak, and hickory, or an incredible $149 a square foot. Plus, loads of major hardwood flooring brands at a crazy 40% off. Even get great deals on laminate, bamboo, and vinyl floors. So go to LumberLiquidators.com today to find the store nearest you. Special 12-month financing available. But hurry, the sale ends Tuesday.
Geico Motorcycle presents Reflections from the Road.
You can't beat the open road, but saving money on motorcycle insurance is a close second. That's why I switched to Geico. Reminds me of the time I switched to a new helmet without a face mask and swallowed a bunch of gnats when I accidentally yawned. Those suckers tasted bad. Unlike Geico Motorcycle Savings, which always taste real good.
Geico Motorcycle Insurance. See how much you could save.
Imagine for a moment a radio program, the most personal of mediums, that reaches hundreds of thousands of people on more than 140 radio stations across the U.S. and around the world through the internet with podcasts and live streams. Imagine the advertising is affordable from $600 to $6,000 a month. Free Talk Live is that program. We will work with you to get clicks, calls, views, or sales. Email me at mark@freetalklive.com.
DVD, books, music, instruments, periodicals, computers, software, electronics, photo, cell phone, office products, home and garden, bed and bath, furniture, kitchen, pet supplies, automotive, hardware, apparel, shoes, jewelry, grocery, healthcare, sports and outdoors, toys, games, used and more. It's a department store at your fingertips. Shop.freetalklive.com. Get all your shopping done, get a great deal, and a portion of your purchase goes to benefit Free Talk Live when you enter Amazon via shop.freetalklive.com.
You're listening to the live edition of Free Talk Live. Hour number two is next, after the news, here on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
This is the Liberty Beat, your daily source for Liberty news and activist updates, online at thelibertybeat.com. I'm Brian Hagan with your Liberty Beat for Friday, August 8th, 2014. Gold opened today at $1,307, silver opened at $19.84, and Bitcoin is trading around $588.30. Support for Liberty Beat comes from Roberts & Roberts Brokerage Incorporated, specializing in precious metals since 1977. Online at rrbi.co or by phone at 800-874-9760. In the news, the Austin City Council has approved a $1.25 million settlement for the family of Larry Eugene Jackson, the African-American man killed last year by Austin Police Detective Charles Kleinhardt. Larry Eugene was unarmed and chased down by Detective Kleinhardt after approaching a bank where police were investigating an attempted robbery. Larry left the scene after police began questioning him and a chase ensued. Larry was never lawfully detained and was not a suspect in the bank incident. The council voted 6-1 for the settlement, with only Mayor Lee Leffingwell casting a no vote. According to the Austin American-Statesman, Thursday's settlement was the largest of its kind in Austin history. On Saturday, tomorrow, at Brave New Books in Austin, join the Alliance of Austin Agorists as they host Catherine Bleich, Justin and Jessica Armon, and Tracy Ward, four Central Texas residents who have had relative success enterprising in agorist ventures. Join the community from 6 until 10 o'clock for an open discussion on what it takes to find freedom. The event will also feature an agorist farmers market. The Central Texas Healthy Mothers, Healthy Babies Coalition will host a screening of the Milky Way movie tomorrow, Saturday, August 9th, at the Alamo Draft House located on Slaughter Lane. The movie is all about breastfeeding culture and breastfeeding history in the United States. The screening will be followed by a panel discussion and an opportunity to ask questions about the movie and breastfeeding in general. Tickets include lunch and can be purchased on drafthouse.com. The screening begins at 1 p.m. Children are welcome to attend. To learn more, visit keepaustinbreastfeeding.org. Support for Liberty Beat comes from Brave New Books, your local source for all things Bitcoin, now hosting a Bitcoin ATM. Located in Austin, Texas at 1904 Guadalupe Street or online, bravenewbookstore.com. And support comes from the notorious activist Michael Cargill, who has a new show called Come and Talk It, live Sunday afternoons at 4 o'clock on 1370 AM in Austin. That's 1370 AM, Sundays at 4. This is the Liberty Beat for Friday, August 8th, 2014. Check out the website at thelibertybeat.com. The FBI has arrested a Homeland Security employee under charges that he solicited sex with a mother and her underage daughter via Craigslist. George Trafosky is accused of posting an ad on Craigslist in the casual encounters section looking for a mom interested in allowing a man to teach her daughter about sex. Hertovsky traded pictures and emails with undercover officers that he believed to be an interested mother. His LinkedIn profile lists him as an inspector with the Department of Homeland Security, specifically the TSA. A TSA spokesman told the San Francisco Gate he was suspended indefinitely and in the process of being fired. Former NSA contractor and whistleblower Edward Snowden has been granted a 3-year residency permit in Russia. One of Snowden's lawyers revealed details of the arrangement at a press conference in Moscow, stating that Snowden is free to move across the country and travel abroad. The news comes on the heels of the Russian government announcing bans of U.S. and EU food, fruits, and vegetables. In an attempt to comply with the Digital Accountability and Transparency Act passed by Congress last year, USAspending.gov released the results of an audit of all government spending and found an astounding $619 billion missing from over 300 different federal programs. Who was the biggest offender? The Department of Health and Human Services. They failed to report nearly $544 billion. Overall, the audit showed that only 2% to 7% of the recorded spending data in 2012 was consistent with agencies' records. Support for the Liberty Beat comes from Cabo Bob's, non-GMO chips, homemade tortillas, and no high fructose corn syrup in anything. Visit them at one of their two locations in Austin, 500 East Ben White Boulevard and 2828 Rio Grande near UT campus. This is the Liberty Beat for Friday, August 8th, 2014. I'm Brian Hagan reporting, reminding you, spread liberty with a smile.
Now, how much money will all those closeted Republican convention goers bring into the city, Marie?
A lot. The average area prostitute normally makes around $200 to $300 a week, jerking off truck drivers behind the bus station.
I see.
Next week, they are expecting to make 30 times that amount, sucking off secretly gay Republicans.
Wow.
You figure the fact that these delegates are so repressed and filled with self-hatred,
yes,
they tend to like the filthiest, kinkiest sex acts imaginable.
Oh, that's
right.
Which
tends to cost more. The average well-adjusted gay man has no desire to smear fecal matter all over his partner's face or be beat up by him. But that is exactly the sort of thing that these repressed conservatives are willing to pay top dollar for.
Okay, as well as the services of transsexuals, I understand.
Yes. A lot of the Republicans repeatedly call the prostitutes faggots or start crying after they've had sex with them.
I suppose the prostitutes are shoring up on their politics so they can talk to the Republicans.
Ha ha, Andrea, what do you think this is, Pretty Woman? They're just there to get
right. Thank you, Marie Byron.
Oh, RNC's always a good time.
This is the Onion News Network.
This is Free Talk Live, the live Sunday night show. We're kicking off the second hour of tonight's program, and it's me, Stephanie, here with you.
And Brian.
And Mark.
You can call us and bring up anything that's on your mind, as always, at 855-450-3733 or on Skype at lrn.fm. And, you know, we've got a lot of stuff to talk about tonight. This was a story that you brought in, Mark, I want to go with next, that was just, you know, it's outrageous, but I think I heard the headline and said, well, this, I was waiting for this to happen, basically. When was this going to happen? Because it just follows kind of almost logically in a weird way from all the stories of zero tolerance gone wrong in schools.
Well, so, this is a setup is what this is. I don't know what it was like for you guys. You guys are younger than I am. I'm 43. And in school, we had show and tell.
Yeah, but we had show and tell, too.
But show and tell almost had these unspoken prohibition against bringing in toys. This was more about bringing in things you've found, like going for a walk in nature and bringing in a turtle shell or something like that. It was all about, you know, it had more to do with learning than playing, I guess, is what, you know, our show and tell was like at my particular school. And I'm interested in knowing, you know, from anybody, is what was your show and tell like at your school? Was it mostly about toys? Because I kind of am of the theory, I'm of the opinion, kids are fat today because they don't get out and play like I got out and played. the the way that I was in kindergarten riding my bike with training wheels to the next street over. Today, you can find parents getting arrested for letting seven-year-olds, this was when I was six, letting seven-year-olds go for a walk to the park. You can find a variety of different stories where it's illegal, apparently, to let your nine-year-old play in the park while you work at McDonald's a couple of, you know, just like a block down or whatever. And
wow.
So, I mean, I don't know. I can't speak to what I think is, you know, arrestable and what's not arrestable, but I think that kids are sheltered, and so therefore show and tell is more likely to turn into toy and tell because kids spend more time with
toys.
When are
they going to be out finding rocks when they're sheltered inside all the time?
Yeah, mine was definitely toy and tell.
Was it?
Yeah, toys all the way.
Yeah, I don't remember a prohibition on toys or anything, but it was kind of mixed. Like, some people brought in cool stuff from their parents' travels or wherever they went.
Yeah.
Some people brought in toys, and some people brought in like animals and stuff.
I don't think that animals were acceptable in our school, but I could be wrong.
Now it's like, you can't bring a turtle because you're going to get salmonella. You can't bring a dog because it might bite someone. You can't bring a cat because someone might be allergic, you know?
Yeah, like, the whole thing.
Leaves hamsters.
Now there's something else you can't bring in. Warner Robins, Georgia. After a couple of days into the school year, fourth grader, Ramsey McDonald of Warner Robins was given what he thought was a fun assignment. Bring in some of your favorite toys to talk about. Now this is not show and tell. This is bring in some of your favorite toys to talk about.
Favorite toys, yeah.
Now, we would have never done this in my school. You know, toys, you didn't bring them. It just, you know, toys were something we didn't even talk about, really.
Yeah.
We had blocks and things.
They had toys in the classroom.
Toys in the classroom, but they were almost, you know, they were sort of school toys, the kind of toys, you know, blocks and build roads and a variety of things, as opposed to little plastic action figures or something.
With all the talk about how competitive kids can get about like clothes, you would think that they wouldn't want kids bringing in toys because they might get jealous of the other kids' toys or they can't afford them, their family can't afford them.
Listen to what Ramsey was going to bring in here. They said here the father, Scott, says, they were trying to get to know each other. They were trying to get the kids to know each other. The Miller Elementary School student told his father Friday he was going to bring in his iPad and a couple of toys. So, you know, Ramsey's got himself an iPad already. And if anybody's going to be jealous of anything, it's going to be of an iPad, it would seem to me. McDonald learned this, I assume this is a father, that it wasn't okay when he received a call from the school Tuesday. They told me my son brought a weapon to school and they asked me if I was aware.
A weapon?
A weapon, yep.
Like an AK-47? Or what?
I asked them what it was, and they said it was a plastic Nerf gun.
Shock, horror. Yeah.
So McDonald said that he knew that his child was planning on taking the blue, orange, and green plastic gun to class. And I think it's important to point out that this is a clearly, unless you believe that a pastel-colored stormtrooper blaster is somehow really a weapon, that no one is going to mistake this for a weapon.
What kind of projectiles does a Nerf gun shoot? I mean, aren't they like these soft kind of foam football things?
I can't look at this particular photo, but I would imagine if it's like the Nerf gun that my son has, it's like it's just a small cylinder, maybe as big around as a nickel, you know, and the diameter of a nickel, but it's much longer, of course.
Right.
And then it has some fins on it. So it's a dart that's maybe 4 inches long.
Mm-hmm. All foam, though.
All foam. I mean, you couldn't hurt anybody with this. I don't know how. You might be able to shove it down their throat bodily with your finger. Would be probably the only way you could hurt somebody with this.
Yeah, doesn't exactly have stopping power, huh?
Yeah, I think that the only thing that, like, maybe if a baby got a hold of this and like began to nurse on it and got it down their throat, that would be the only way that a child, other than, you know, like I said, taking like a golf club handle and jamming the dart down somebody's throat. But that's really the golf club handle. I don't know what you could do to possibly.
Yeah, well, I mean, and even that, the gun itself, you know, the Nerf, even the bows that they sell look preposterous. I mean, they look nothing like any, and the colors are far out. Like you said, pastel. The colors are really far out. I mean, they make these things look as much
Not like a gun,
not like any weapon that possibly could ever get existed or even would make sense by the laws of physics as they can. And that's weird.
So the child was initially given 3 days suspension, which was reduced, I guess, after the father complained.
3 days? Wow.
3 days in-school suspension.
ISS.
Now, the in-school suspension, I don't care. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, school is in-school suspension.
Yeah, but, totally. I'm with you.
But you know, I mean, what you're doing is you're scolding this kid.
Yeah,
you're
they're putting
making
him in
an example of him.
Yeah,
that's exactly what it's about. And the other kids, you know, kids often love another kid to get in trouble. They don't really care why it is. You rarely find kids console, you know, like, oh man, I can't believe that happened. He was usually like, ha ha.
Or at least it didn't happen to me, basically, is the idea, because they're so deep in this society where everybody's kind of having power over them. You know, they like it when they have a chance to have a little bit of power over someone else.
Yeah, the one thing that I can, my son plays, you know, with other kids and that kind of thing. And one thing I find, and usually it's kids with brothers and sisters, is the snitching culture that goes on. My son knows nothing of the snitching culture because I don't want anything to do with it.
Yeah.
You know, good, like, work it out. Try not to hit each other. That's, you know, how it is for me. But there's a lot of that goes on. And in that, you're essentially telling on a behavior that, you know, the other kid did so that you can then see the punishment meted out in front of you.
Or maybe to earn brownie points with the teacher.
Could be.
Something like that.
In the cases that I've seen it seems to be that they want the flogging. You know,
yeah.
Let the flogging begin.
Don't you think adults kind of still have some of that?
There's lots of people that haven't grown up past elementary school. Absolutely.
I mean, we get calls on the show all the time, just people gloating about criminals being sent to jail and getting the death penalty and stuff like that, right?
Well, I mean, I think that there's deserve, I think, is a funny term, right? But I do think that some people deserve certain punishments. But I don't know. I mean,
there's a difference between thinking that it's just and like celebrating it almost, you know, like, or the reaction to like Osama bin Laden's death, you know, where people were like drinking and partying in the streets. It was just like, there was a lot of criticism there because they're celebrating the death of a human being. Like it doesn't matter. It's this Osama bin Laden.
If you feel good about a punishment meted out for a crime, you should, like, for me, what that means is that I would want that punishment meted out to me if I did it. I don't think any of us are above others when it comes to, you know, things out there. And I think that that's, you need to consider what punishment do you want to see meted out to you and yours if they do something. And I think that that's fine. I mean, I really do. I'm not against punishment as a paradigm. But I think that it should be just. I think it should be, you know, commensurate to the crime. And it's difficult for me to know exactly what that is.
I question the usefulness of punishment, honestly. I mean, it doesn't, if a crime has a victim, and I think for libertarians, they would say, yes, if something is a crime, that means there is a victim, a clear person who was harmed. And does punishing the criminal do anything to restitute the victim? No, it doesn't do anything to give the victim back what they lost, to come to terms with what the criminal did.
What if the victim wants punishment? There's this story that was about a year ago.
Does it matter what the victim? Oh, sorry. I thought you were saying the criminal anyway.
Crashed. The Death of the Dollar. It's a hot new novel that has a lot of people talking. It explores what our government's reaction to a U.S. currency collapse would be. And when the government nationalizes all supply chains in an effort to keep order, the sentiment voiced towards such a tyranny is, we're not picking the fight. The government already did that. We'll just be fighting back for a change. This is a great book, but don't take my word for it. Look at the reviews on Amazon. Bernie says, Crashed is a really terrifying trip. It is thought-provoking. It makes you wonder, what if? Could this happen? Gary Jones adds, this is an excellent book. It is also a little scary because it could very well be true. I hope it's fiction, and Julia Moffat calls it a gripping read and the most exciting and thoughtful book this year. Crashed is a fast-paced read that has 2/3 of its Amazon reviewers calling for a sequel. This book is totally worth your time. It's well-researched, liberty-oriented, realistic, gripping, and gritty. Do yourself a favor and don't miss this one. Get your copy at Amazon. Crashed, The Death of the Dollar by William Cooper.
Gold, it's like nothing else on Earth. From the Romans through the Renaissance, from the Industrial Age to the Space Age, gold has weathered the test of time. For 6,000 years, gold has remained the ultimate store of wealth. According to the World Gold Council and the U.S. Mint, demand is at an all-time high. The stage is being set for the reemergence of gold as the common-sense alternative to a fiat paper currency that gets weaker every day. Midas Resources is proud to offer the hard-hitting report that arms you with the truth you need to protect you and your family from the Fed's plans for your hard-earned money. Don't gamble with your future. Call Midas Resources today and ask for your free copy of As Good as Gold. Call 1-800-686-2233.
1-800-237-7237 for the report the Fed hopes you'll never see. As good as gold can be yours by calling 800-686-2237. If you have ever thought about owning gold, you must read this report. Call Midas today at 800-686-2237.
Do you need access to money? Do you need cash today? If you are receiving a structured settlement due to a lawsuit, or you are receiving pension payments over a long period of time, the Money Settlement Hotline can get you instant funding now. With your cash today, you can pay off credit card debt, pay medical bills, fund your education, or improve your home. You don't need to wait. It's true. If you're receiving a structured settlement or pension payment spread out over time and you want a lump sum amount immediately, then you need to call now. They will turn your long-term structured settlement or pension payments into a lump sum larger cash payout, so you'll get all of your money instantly. If you have a structured settlement or pension and you want cash today, call the Money Settlement Hotline right now. 888-785-0616. 888-785-0616. 888-785-0616. That's 888-785-0616.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. It's my firm belief that Free Talk Live's AMP program is the best use of your charitable dollar among liberty-oriented organizations. Support all the organizations you love. But make sure you give $5 a month to AMP at amp.freetalklive.com.
When I found the Free State Project, I knew it was the key to achieving liberty in my lifetime. It's awesome to be surrounded by like-minded, freedom-loving activists who've moved here to New Hampshire. From politics to civil disobedience, we have it all. Where I came from, it felt that no matter what I did, liberty was dying. Perhaps you feel the same way? Call 888-377-2515 now to learn more about the Free State Project. That's 888-377-2515 or visit freestateproject.org.
While our satellite channel is free to listen to, it's not free for us. You can help us cover our satellite costs with the chip-in on the right side of the page at lrn.fm.
This is Free Talk Live. You're listening to the live Sunday night show with me, Stephanie.
And Brian.
And Mark.
And our number is 855-450-FREE. Tell us what you think about this kid who got suspended from school for bringing in a Nerf gun for show and tell. Is that like entrapment or something?
Well, they told him it wasn't even show and tell. It was bring in your favorite toy. Now, in your favorite toy, but don't make sure it's not a gun would have been sort of fair. But telling a kid bring in your favorite toy sounds like bring in your favorite toy, doesn't it?
Right. And, of course, our phone lines, 855-450-FREE, are brought to you by ProXPN.
Yeah, and ProXPN is something you want if you care about your privacy. And privacy is a right, so take it. And you can do that by going to ProXPN.com. This is going to give you what this is. It's a VPN service, okay? That's virtual private network, and it's going to encrypt all your data and metadata that goes up from your device. This works on Windows, OS X, Linux, iOS, Android, whatever you put on your smartphone, put on whatever you want, and it's going to encrypt that data before it gets to the ISPs, to the carriers, whatever. This is a phenomenal service. You can get it incredibly inexpensive. Use the code FTL20, okay? And you'll get it to, if you go with their annual plan, you'll get it for about, just about $5 a month. That's a month. That's like the cost of a decent cup of coffee. And so, really, you want this. It is so important. It's not just about the NSA. It's not just about, crackers. It's about when you're going to get a job. Because your ISPs will keep all that data that we're talking about. They'll keep it for up to 5 years. Sometimes, who knows if it could go longer. And your digital privacy is analogous, ironically, to your analog life. It really is. This is something you can run this all the time. There's no reason not to be using a VPN service. And also, if you happen to be a traveler, this will get you past some of the more nasty filters that exist in other countries to get to your favorite websites.
So I love the idea that it just does protect me from the NSA just kind of looking. And I don't really care that much, but I just don't care that they care to have them looking.
Right.
Plus, you never know if somebody's, if you're not using a VPN and you forget and you go out in public and you use some kind of public Wi-Fi, bam, your credit card information, your Bitcoin information, all this stuff can be snagged.
Oh, yeah. I think this is incredibly important when you're going to conferences, when you're going to just an airport, when you're going to McDonald's and you're using their Wi-Fi. This is
you're encrypted from the device on out.
Right, exactly. It's done what they call client-side. It uses OpenVPN, which that is the most trusted form of VPN service out there. It is open source. It's been tested by the geeks. Go to proxpn.com, use the code FTL20, and get your privacy.
Awesome. Yep, we love ProXPN here on Free Talk Live. And let's go to the phones and talk to Jim in Virginia. Hey, Jim, you're on Free Talk Live. What's on your mind?
Hey, guys, calling about the heinous gun crime with a little kid.
Yeah, he was really a dangerous menace to society, huh?
The people in the article I read, the superintendent said, we did not think it was a weapon. We did, at no point did we believe this was a weapon in any way. So it's not about any kind of safety. This is the intersection of two liberal dreams that you, of course, have in government schools. One, demonize all firearms and train people that they're bad and you can't have them and they're evil just by existing. And two, they're criminalizing being a male in this society.
You know, the kid, what does that have to do with being a male?
Well, let me explain. You ask any 11-year-old boy, I've got one, you know, you raise them to be as liberal as possible. Jane Fonda raises one. Boys will bite a piece of American cheese into the shape of a gun. They will get a stick into a gun. Boys want to play guns. That's why Nerf made that product. Okay, boys want to go pow-pow, and they have since guns were invented. And before that, they did sword fights. Boys want
they still do sword
do that.
Fights.
So you don't believe that if a girl had brought a Nerf gun into school that she would have been suspended too? I mean, we don't have a really fair case to compare because there was no girl that this happened to, but what do you think would have happened?
No, I'm not doing that, but I just what I'm saying is if you're a little boy growing up in this society, okay, you get a really good chance of not having a father in the home. You go to school, all the teachers are females. All the principals more or less are females. The people who taught them in college are females. And so it's an anti-male bias in society. You can't play with guns. You can't be a boy. When Leave It to Beaver went to school, he had like five recesses because they knew boys need to go out and run.
You know,
now boys are.
I hear what you're saying, but there's a problem here, and that is that no teachers are telling the military to not be in school. I know that's high school and we're talking elementary school, but this is a real issue. If these people were so consistent about the deploring violence, then they would tell the military, the recruiters, don't you ever step foot in this school, and they don't.
Well, I would have to say that mostly the gun grabbing liberals. Wait just a second. I'd say mostly the gun-grabbing liberals only want to grab guns from people when they are not working for the government. So specifically, they believe the cops should be able to carry guns and soldiers should be able to carry guns, but not even when they're off duty.
Yeah, they want the forces of repression. They want the forces of centralized control to have guns. But your point you made is not true.
What's that?
About military recruitment. There's a huge. They had to pass a law. Congress passed a law saying you had to. Every Ivy League school barred military recruiters.
Well, that's in college.
Well, yeah, in high schools, it's pretty. It seems pretty easy.
Okay,
and actually, go ahead.
Well, I'm just saying.
They're not getting their bullet catchers from Ivy League schools. I'll tell you that.
Well, they were after 9/11. There was a lot of recruitment for smart people to get in the military and get in the intelligence community, and those institutions are controlled by people that don't like America and don't want it to be victorious, and they do not like the military, and they were keeping the military out.
Yeah, I don't know. I see. I see your point, but I generally don't see society as particularly in America as a bunch of pacifists. I see them as quite the opposite.
Well, I tend to be sort of 50-50 with the caller here. So the one thing's for sure is that boys are not doing as well in school as they used to. Something's happened that either the focus on girls has either brought them up to the level they should be, or the focus on girls has taken a focus away from boys.
Yeah, I mean, we can look at the rates of basically boys get prescribed Ritalin way more often and diagnosed with ADHD and stuff, which you could really make an argument that they're actually normal. What's wrong with the scenario is the adults, you know, not letting them run around and be themselves.
Yeah, well, yeah, I could. When my son gets in with another kid in the house, it can be too much for me. It's like, good Lord, can't you two settle down? But I really don't tell them to. I just go do something outside because I think they do need to yell and holler. As long as they're not breaking things, they need to be able to, you know, go pow pow and do whatever they do.
And if I could bring up another point, go ahead, caller.
Well, no, what the young lady said is exactly the case, and that's where I was going, is girls by their nature, and of course there's exceptions both ways, but girls by their nature can fold their hands and sit in a chair neatly and socially interact for hours on end. Boys, you know, 11 years old, they need to run and scream and jump and break things. And you used to go out to the recess a lot to do that, but now it's just a world where there's just so little male influence that women educators are like, why are all these boys acting like boys? Why won't they be like the girls that give them drugs?
Jim, thanks for your thoughts tonight. This is Free Talk Live. There's more coming up. 855-450-FREE. Are boys being turned into women? Are they being feminized? I don't know. I had some trouble staying still in school. I couldn't really fold my hands.
Jessica Armand here, creator of My Magic Mud, the all-natural teeth whitener and strengthening remedy that's getting rave reviews from GCN listeners. Here's what Austin dentist Dr. Griffin Cole has to say about it.
I really love this Magic Mud product. Because charcoal is so absorbent, it's very effective at taking off all the sticky plaque and debris that gets stuck on our teeth every day. I highly recommend My Magic Mud.
Visit MyMagicMud.com to hear the full interview with Dr. Cole. Get your jar today. That's MyMagicMud.com.
This is Dan Pilla. Do you owe the IRS money you can't pay? Are tax debts crippling you? I've defended people from the IRS for over 30 years. I've helped thousands, and I can help you too. I wrote the book on IRS settlement, and I'm telling you, there's no such thing as a hopeless case. Call 800-34-NO-TAX to finally get free of IRS debt. With the IRS's new programs, there's never been a better time to solve your problem. Call 800-34-NO-TAX. That's 800-34-NO-TAX or my website, danpilla.com.
Free Press Publications is an independent alternative media and publishing company founded in June 2009 with the mission of ensuring a free press for the freedom movement and is committed to spreading the message of peace, freedom, love, and liberty. FPP also gives new authors an avenue for publishing freedom-oriented material. FPP brings you daily news and commentary at fpp.cc, as well as weekly news in the FPP Freedom Minute and Peace, Love, Liberty Radio at fppradio.com. The monthly newspaper FPP News at news.fpp.cc and books at shop.fpp.cc. Find FPP online at fpp.cc. That's fpp.cc, as in Creative Commons.
This Your Family Today tip is brought to you by Lil Drums. Every bit as fun as a full-size Nestle drumstick cone and definitely cuter. Visit us at drumstick.com. Vacations are all about family time, but you don't have to leave home to have fun. Take one weekend a month and devote it to family activities. Pull out the board games and puzzles, serve up some treats, or have a picnic. Even without leaving home, you'll feel like you've really had some time away. For more tips like these, visit us at parenthood.com/yourfamilytoday.
You can listen to Free Talk Live on the radio, podcast, satellite, webcam, and our live streams. But did you know you can listen to Free Talk Live from any phone, anywhere? Add this number to your phone, 213-493-0308. It's a long-distance call, so make sure you're familiar with your phone's calling plan. The listen lines are airing the latest episode of Free Talk Live 24 hours a day, including our live shows. Call 213-493-0308. That's 213-493-0308. On Free Talk Live, we're bringing people to the ideas of liberty every day. From wrestling superstars like Glenn Jacobs.
You guys really are having an impact, I believe. Like I said, a lot of where I am now is due to listening to Free Talk Live. You changed my mind on some very important issues years ago.
To random people tuning in on the radio.
I was kind of stuck in the left-right paradigm. I heard your show by chance on a Saturday night. From there, I went on, joined the Free State Project, and become an amplifier. So, I mean, that's really the reason why I amp is because I know that if it wasn't for you guys being on as many stations as you are, I never would have found the ideas of Liberty.
Your amp will directly change more lives by getting Free Talk Live in front of people looking for talk radio online and on the air. Find out about giving to our Google AdWords campaign at amp.freetalklive.com. That's amp.freetalklive.com.
Help get LRN.FM into more ears. Visit promote.lrn.fm for a free bumper sticker, flyers, banners, graphics, and more. Promote.lrn.fm.
You are listening to Free Talk Live. It's the live Sunday night show with me, Stephanie.
And Brian.
And Mark.
855-450-FREE is the toll-free call-in number from ProXPN, sponsored by them. And you can also call on Skype at lrn.fm. Skype has great sound quality. We love to hear people's voices coming in crystal clear, but phones work too. You know, sometimes there's a pretty decent connection even over the phone lines.
If you want to get into Bitcoins, there's two things you need. You need a wallet, and a wallet is just essentially an online account. You can go get one for free at blockchain.info. Now, I would never recommend that you go get an account from any organization that holds your Bitcoins online because, well, for one, I lost a bunch of Bitcoins to an organization that held my Bitcoins online. Blockchain, they don't. They encrypt your wallet right in your browser. Now, admittedly, you don't see how they don't have your Bitcoins, but Brian, our tech expert, will assure you that they don't have your Bitcoins.
They do not have your Bitcoins. You have complete control at all times, which if you don't want complete control of your money, which your Bitcoins are at all times, why not just deal with the banks then?
Just give it to them.
Yeah.
If you're not responsible enough to deal with your own money, then maybe you shouldn't have it and just give it to some banks.
Blockchain does it right.
The flip side of that is you need to be responsible for your security.
Yep, you've got to keep your password. You know,
and it's only sometimes as secure as your own email address.
Indeed.
So you know, take precautions, turn on two-factor authentication, secure your personal email. Don't have backups sent to your email if it's not secure.
Yeah, I actually use a special email address for my blockchain.
That is a great tip.
Yep. Yeah.
So just go to blockchain.com. You can get their new app for your, I guess they have it for the iPhone now too. So Android and
iPhone. Yes, it finally came back to iPhone.
There you go, blockchain.com. Now, blockchain.info is the main meaty site.
Right.
But that blockchain.com is the easy place to go get the apps. So blockchain.com, blockchain.info.
All right. Now, we do have a call on the line, guys, but we wanted to just sort of wrap up that conversation we were having with Jim in the last segment, who was basically, his premise, I think, was that boys are being, you know, kind of beat down in schools because the whole...
it's the feminization of boys in America.
Right. It's the feminization. All the teachers are female. It's a conspiracy against the boys. And like you said, Mark, you know, there are some truths to that. Like, it's true that boys are drugged at a higher rate and diagnosed with these very flimsy psychiatric diagnoses that are just kind of an excuse to pump them full of drugs and shut them up, essentially.
I think there's this sort of attitude, and I don't know where it came from, but this attitude that men are adult children, and so therefore the children of adult children, these children that will grow up to be adult children, are probably dismissed by women more and more. You know, I mean, there's this war of the sexes that goes on, whether or not we want to talk about it. And I'm not saying everybody's participating. Some of us are on the sidelines.
Yeah, I don't want to participate in it.
But that doesn't mean you're not going to get a headshot along the way. You know, fortunately, you're in a romantic relationship with somebody. That's probably not going to be the case. But I think that by and large, there's still a war of the sexes on. And
yeah, but okay. So if we acknowledge that's true, and I think I would acknowledge that's true, feminists say that patriarchy hurts men as much as it hurts women.
Does it matter what feminists say when, are these teachers feminists?
Well, no, but a teacher is a job that is basically a female gender role. Like, it's traditionally, you know, there has been this idea that the only appropriate jobs for a woman to have are basically secretary, teacher, and nurse. Those kind of things. And so, sure, a lot of women ended up as teachers because that was sort of the expectation. And perhaps those teachers maybe do have a likelihood of treating boys a little bit differently, but it's all part of the same system that says that women can only be teachers, secretaries, and nurses. And maybe if that weren't the case, then there would be more male teachers or maybe different treatment of boys in schools.
Yeah, this brings up one of the points I wanted to make before the end of the last segment, but we didn't have time. And that is, and it is a response to one of the things the caller said. And the caller was very gracious to say, look, there's exceptions to all this stuff. And absolutely. And I think he's right.
Yeah.
But the idea, he brought up the idea that, look, boys want to, you know, if it wasn't guns, then they'd pick up swords. If it wasn't, you know, the thing is that you are implying that, let's say, what, a 4, 5-year-old, 6-year-old has devised weaponry by nature, because this is the idea, is that they naturally do this. This is in their nature that they do this. So today, for today's example, by nature, a 5-year-old boy figures out a gun, figures out how to invent, not just figures out how to use it, but invented a gun that, yes, I will have a stick that will shoot a bullet. No, a 5-year-old can't figure that stuff out. And I'll say it's a sword. Then, you know, I mean, swords, all these different weapons and stuff. You're saying that kids naturally figure out how to create weapons without in a vacuum?
I don't know if that's the implication. I think it is the implication,
but people don't think about it, Stephanie.
No, I think if you think about it, what the implication is that violence is a part of maleness. I think that's what they're saying, is that basically they're seeing guns on TV, and so they express it by turning a piece of cheese into a gun, but that the violence is the thing that's hard-coded into their nature. And I'm not sure if I even accept that, you know, like that's kind of an insult to men, frankly,
right, but
that they're all so violent that they're just going to be, you know.
Yes, but the weaponry is the proof of that assessment of theirs.
Yep.
And but what I'm saying is that that's nonsense. There's no way a kid did that in a vacuum. He saw someone do it. He saw swords. He saw guns. He saw whatever these things are.
Right.
This is crap.
If a kid is acting out violence, you know, kids are great at mirroring things. So like where did they see that violence portrayed before they started acting it out is a question that I think needs an answer, right?
If we eliminated violence in movies, video games, and media and everything today, and then started in a new world, I would agree with you, they wouldn't mimic it.
Right.
However, somebody would then create violence in movies, video games, because violence is compelling. And
I'm
it's
not talking
easy...
about movies. I'm talking about like...
But Brian
perhaps...
is. Brian's saying that kids use guns and swords and punches because
I honestly think they're more likely to just copy what their parents are doing, and parents do a fair amount of violence in this society, including hitting their
kids. Wherever they got it from, but the point is that they didn't learn that in a vacuum.
Okay, my son has never seen me wield a gun. Hadn't seen me wield a gun, a sword, or hit his mother, mm-hmm. Or hit anything at all in his life, and still does all the things that other kids do because he mm-hmm. watched TV, mm-hmm. and TV has these compelling, interesting things like cartoons where, you know, Captain America punches a bad guy or whatever goes on. So I think that violence is compelling in a storytelling fashion, mainly because most of our storytelling mediums are visual, and it's a lot easier to illustrate conflict with violence than it is to illustrate conflict sort of, I don't like him, or he upsets me, or something like that. It's just not as compelling.
Yeah, sure. I mean, and if the resolution's not violent, you end up with, War and Peace, you know, Dostoevsky or whatever,
right.
and it ends up being this 1,200-page book. But Stephanie, you had another quick point I thought that was great.
What was that?
About military in the high school.
Oh, yeah. So thanks for reminding me about that, Brian, and then we'll get to Adam's call in just a moment. But I have a friend who does counter-recruitment activism. She works with Veterans for Peace, and they're an organization that puts out information that basically presents an alternative view to what the military recruiters will tell children in schools, that, you know, the military recruiters are saying, oh, yeah, join the Army. It's great. You'll see the world. You'll get your college paid for. It's awesome. And these counter-recruitment organizations put out more of a view of what actually happens when you join the military, which can often be very different than that. And my friend has to just fight she's been fighting for years to try to get some space in the schools alongside where the National Guard and the Army have set up their recruitment tables. And they won't let her in, but they'll let the military recruiters in, no problem.
Yeah, Veterans for Peace has tried as well. They just can't get in.
Yeah.
The schools won't let them.
The Second Circuit Court of Appeals has ruled that they have to let counter-recruiters in if they let recruiters into a school, and they still don't do it.
Yeah. And this is in a liberal area of San Francisco. So, I mean, what's it like in California, other places? There are probably no counter-recruitment organizations to speak of. But anyway, we've got a call coming in from Adam in Maryland. Hey, Adam, you're on Free Talk Live. What's on your mind?
Hey. You guys were talking about intellectual property. You wanted somebody to call in if they supported it.
Yeah. Are you a supporter?
Well, it depends on what you define IP as.
IP Daily.
Why don't you tell me what you define IP as?
Intellectual property. What do you guys define intellectual property as?
I don't know that I'm ready to just spit out the world's greatest definition, but I would say that basically it's the ownership of an idea. That you come up
it's
with some
mind fruit.
You come up with some idea, and that because I thought of it first, you get to keep it. Or if you say that joke, you're going to have to tell everybody that you got it from me, or whatever the concept is behind it. And I think that it's a concept that resonates with people.
Yeah, because physical property, I think a lot of people would define physical property as, an object that you have the ability to exclude other people from using, right? It belongs to you and you can keep other people away. And that idea sort of extends to the way that people define intellectual property, I think, which is that you own an idea and you can exclude other people from using your idea.
Yeah, see, this is where we get a little confused because I know you guys had mentioned something about downloads.
The first month is free. Sign up and say hello.
Question: could too many GMO foods and toxins be overloading your digestive and immune systems? Answer: yes. If you're searching for a powerful detox that's gentle enough to use every day, use Pro EM1 from Terriganics. Pro EM1 is a powerful liquid probiotic that uses good bacteria to suppress pathogens and gently eliminate toxins from your body. A healthy digestive system will cleanse and remove toxins, support weight loss, improve absorption of food nutrients, and aid in controlling yeast and other infections. Pro EM1 is made with only non-GMO and certified organic ingredients, has no preservatives, and is dairy, soy, wheat, and gluten-free. Pro EM1 is the key to your digestive health. Order Pro EM1 Daily Probiotic Cleanse at Terraganix.com, spelled TERRAGANIX.com. Or call toll-free 866-369-3678. That's 866-369-3678. Also available through Amazon Prime. Pro EM1 from Terriganix. Life's getting better.
Are you looking for an excuse to come check out New Hampshire this fall? You're invited to Keenvention. Keenvention is your chance to meet dozens of key liberty activists from across the Shire. You can explore the beautiful little city of Keene, discuss various forms of activism with seasoned veterans, do some Robin Hooding, and learn about making the move. Keenvention received rave reviews last year. If you missed it, visit keenvention.info for full video coverage of every speaker and panel. This year, Rich Paul is our first announced keynote speaker, and more are being announced now at keenvention.info. Join old and new friends and neighbors in Keene for Keenvention this October 31st through November 2nd. You can pre-order your tickets now for just $60 at keenvention.info, or you can pay with Bitcoin. Visit keenvention.info for more information and to lock in your tickets at the pre-order $60 price for the whole weekend. Visit keenvention.info for more, or look for our page and event on Facebook. That's keenvention.info. Did you know that you can listen to and watch Free Talk Live during our live show 7 days a week from 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern via our studio cam at cam.freetalklive.com? Not only that, but you can also chat with other listeners at the same time. Do I need to mention that both the studio cam and chat room are totally free? Outside of Free Talk Live's live hours, you won't see a cam feed, but we'll hear audio from the Liberty Radio Network. So listen, watch, and chat all free at cam.freetalklive.com. That's cam.freetalklive.com.
Are you a political activist who does things that the government might not like? Then this free ebook may save your life. Rats is your guide to protecting yourself against snitches, informers, informants, agents provocateur, narcs, finks, and similar vermin. Rats was written by OG libertarian Claire Wolfe. Rats is a short book, easy to read, and available free in many formats. Download Rats free at rats-nosnitch.com. That's rats-nosnitch.com.
This is the Liberty Radio Network, broadcasting the latest liberty-oriented audio content 24 hours a day at LRN.fm.
Hey,
This is Free Talk Live, the live Sunday night show with me, Stephanie.
And Brian.
And Mark.
You can visit our website at freetalklive.com. And by the way, did you know you can watch the show? We stream video of the show live from the studio every night at cam.freetalklive.com. And it's also up on YouTube. So where do you link to the YouTube page from freetalklive.com? Is it just on the website?
I have no clue. I guess you would go and search Free Talk Live on YouTube and see what you came up with.
That was my next suggestion, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. Currently, the cam is trained on the lovely Stephanie.
It's trained right on my chest, in fact.
It's pointing more head-like. It's not like I was that obvious.
My eyes are up here, yeah. Okay.
Actually, if you type in youtube.freetalklive.com, it will take you right there.
Oh, okay. Thank you, Brian. Yeah. See, there we go. Technology solves all our problems. And our number is 855-450-3733, where you can bring up anything that's on your mind. 855-450-FREE, the word free. And, sorry, Mark and I had a little moment there where we looked at each other. I thought he was going to do a read. But let's just go
back. Wait a minute. What's going on?
Am I drunk again?
Awkward radio moments. Anyway, let's go back to Adam on the line in Maryland. Hey, Adam, you're back with us. We had a little technical error at the end of that last break there. Could you go ahead and continue with your thoughts on intellectual property and how you define it?
No problem. You got to get that bumper music fixed so we all don't get cut off, right?
Indeed.
You guys got cut off earlier. I was like, oh no.
Yeah, sometimes it happens. Live radio.
Yep. So intellectual property. This is the thing. I don't support the like patenting the ideas, the concepts. That is just like Mark was talking about. You can't patent a joke. You know, you can't stop somebody from stealing your joke or stealing like an idea that you haven't put into play yet. So that is not what I support. A lot of times people get confused between IP and copyright. They're really two different things.
Yeah, Stefan Kinsella says this too.
IP,
right?
Is a form of copyright. Or excuse me, yeah, copyright's a form of IP. There's three currently legal forms:
patents, trademarks, and copyrights.
That's right.
And they're all slightly different.
And trademarks are, you know, to me, I believe they're the most relevant and sort of legitimate form of intellectual property out there. So if you create a brown bubbly liquid and you call that brown bubbly liquid Coca-Cola and you put it in a red can and you use sort of a flowing cursive script to write it on there, I believe you're defrauding people if that isn't Coca-Cola. Do you know what I mean? If you just kind of create your own Coca-Cola, put it in a red can. As far as I'm concerned, if you create your own Coca-Cola and use Comic Sans and put it in a blue can, then you know, maybe people are just going to try something else. I don't think that you necessarily. But when you're talking about a copyright, you're making something obviously look like something else. Then you're defrauding the customer because they think they're getting something that they're not getting.
Well, so is it the original Coke's responsibility to somehow differentiate themselves and let the customer know, hey, we're the real thing, we're the original?
No, or I think it's the customer's responsibility to sue somebody who defrauds them, but I think that the original
Coke... So you want to get the state involved? You don't think there's a solution outside of using the state?
I don't think that that a tort is necessarily, you know, has to be... I think that there's going to be arbitration organizations that exist no matter where we... You know, humans are going to have disputes. There's going to be dispute resolution organizations. Those organizations... You know, you may use the term tort, and a tort can be created through defrauding. And yes, a company like Coke may decide, I'm going to get together the people that have been defrauded for 75 cents or $1.25 or whatever it is. And yeah, it's, you know, I get enough of them together and we actually have something that's worth bringing forward. And then we can sue the people who are creating this false
Coke. Yeah, that's one solution. But can you think of any other creative ways to differentiate yourself as the original Mark Edge? I mean, like, people do this anyway, even though it's illegal. Like, does Free Talk Live have trademarks on its name? Or?
Nope.
Okay. So that's not a very good example. But what about, like, in China, where there's lots of knockoffs and ripoffs and, I don't know, society seems to get along pretty well?
Yeah, a lot of companies don't want to move into China because they can't protect their trademarks. So, no, mm-hmm. I mean, it isn't functioning as well.
But a lot of people can get bags that look really similar to Gucci bags and have better lives because they don't have to pay as much for them.
There's something very interesting about sort of Gucci bags. And I think that's, you know, that's the best when you're looking at these things. But you can't
copyright, or you can't patent the cut of a purse. But the reason that these have these expensive purses that have these trademarks all over them is because that's the only way that they can distinguish between a $15 purse and a $1,500 purse is the trademark that's on it. It has nothing to do with quality. It has nothing to do with how many pockets are in it. It has nothing to do with anything but the name brand that's on it. So when they cover it in name brands or whatever, then
but then there's lots of to ways it. To kind of sort of copy it without, like,
sure,
you know, like Folkleys.
Folkleys, yeah.
Like, I mean, what do you think, Adam?
Well, like I was saying, when I say I support IP, it's really I support copyright and not intellectual property. That you, like, if somebody comes up with an idea, you can't copyright that. You can't. Somebody can take that idea. That's fine. But, you know, when it comes to things like software, books, movies, TV shows, music, that's where I'm like, look, you know, this stuff is expensive to make, or it takes a lot of time in the case of writing. In the case of writing software, I know people who develop software, and you know, they basically are like, look, you know, if we – now, they've protected their software with dongles. I'm sure Brian's familiar with those.
Yes.
What's a dongle?
It's a little USB key. In this case, it's called an iLock 2. It's specifically made for audio software.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, what happened was when their software wasn't protected hard enough, their sales dropped. The very day that their program was cracked, their sales dropped by 30%. The second day, it dropped by 40%.
Open source software that doesn't even try to enforce, they just make the code completely open? I mean, there's a lot of really successful open source software out there.
Oh, that's, hey, you know, if you can provide yourself a livelihood, and, you know, by having open source software, or if that's your way of getting into the software industry, that's great. I fully support that. As long as it wasn't reverse engineered, that's kind of when, you know, you get into a gray area.
Well, I know what you're saying, Adam. And I think the issue isn't so, what people want to pay for is convenience, not necessarily the thing. That's what we see is what's occurring. Okay. Because when, like with games, like let's take software with games, with video games, if you make it really easy to get your hands on the video game and you make it and you give them good reasons to pay up money for them, like constant updates and things of that nature, like when you take Steam, for example, they will pay out. When you look at, like, on phones, apps, people pay $2 for an app, you know, no problem. And so they will pay for the convenience. And so I think I see what you're saying, but I think what has to happen is that, and maybe it's unfair, but I think what has to happen is that people have to figure out how to give, you know, how to deliver the best possible value to the person that creates the thing. Like with books, I mean, if you make the books, you know, available through Kindle and it's very easy to get your hands on them, people will actually pay instead of not. And so I think you have to show people, you know, that much value in the delivery and not just in the existence of the product.
The problem I have with copyright is that it requires everybody to pay to get your owner to establish your ownership. So I've got things in my house that I establish ownership of by locking the door or putting up a burglar alarm or whatever I do.
Mm-hmm.
But with intellectual property of software, many companies, or music or movies or whatever it is, many companies rely completely on the federal government to enforce their copyright. So they'll find somebody who's, oh, they're using my song or whatever, and then they'll send the, you know, FBI after them.
Right.
And look, I'm not interested in paying government bureaucrats to enforce your your property claim. So I'm fine if you want to create dongles and those kind of things. I think I believe in intellectual property. I just believe it's your responsibility to secure your property.
Yeah, and I think I would agree with that, is that I don't know that there's any good solution that I can think of to this issue, because it is a problem. Look, if someone makes great software, dear God, give them money. You know, pay for it, please. Or whatever. If they make a great book, pay for it.
And movies. I think that blockbuster movies are a big argument here for intellectual property.
Right, but there's proof.
I don't want to see one taken by somebody's iPhone in the middle of a movie theater. I won't watch a movie that
way. Yeah, there's proof in that, though, too, is that the problem was pirating movies was actually the problem of Hollywood because they were making crap movies. Because once they released great movies, suddenly the sales skyrocketed once again.
Yeah. Adam, any final thoughts real quick?
That was a good discussion, guys. Thanks. Have a good night.
Cool. Thanks for your thoughts, Adam. This is Free Talk Live, 855-450-3733. The third hour of the show is coming up. Bring up anything on your mind.
Safety, safety, safety. I'm saying it three times. Studies show you need to hear something three times to remember it. So remember, safety, safety, safety is important to me, me, me. That's why I love Grainger. Grainger has the products to help keep our facilities safe and people safer. Say it with me, kid. Safety, safety, safety from Grainger, Grainger, Grainger. When you think safety, think Grainger. Get it? Got it? Good. Call clickgrainger.com/safety or stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
Lots of things change in life. Here's one thing that hasn't. For over 20 years, Lumber Liquidators has been the home of unbelievable flooring deals. And right now, those deals are even better. Take your pick of gorgeous pre-finished hardwoods like cherry, oak, and hickory for an incredible $149 a square foot. Plus, loads of major hardwood flooring brands at a crazy 40% off. Even get great deals on laminate, bamboo, and vinyl floors. So go to LumberLiquidators.com today to find the store nearest you. Special 12-month financing available. But hurry, the sale ends Tuesday.
If you want to move to the free state and you're looking for some real estate, well, I know a guy who's really great. It's the realtor Mark Warden. Do you want a home with 20 acres, a lakeside cabin, any takers for renters, buyers, and sellers too? Mark Warden is the guy for you. PorcupineRealEstate.com.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. You likely buy all kinds of things online. Amazon is the largest online retailer. You can get what you need at the same prices with free Super Saver shipping by going to shop.freetalklive.com. Please do your online shopping at shop.freetalklive.com.
You're listening to the live edition of Free Talk Live. Hour number three is next after the news here on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Daryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Sunday, August 10th, 2014. Silver is trading at $19.89 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,310 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $591. Antiwar.com reports, since his Thursday night announcement that he had authorized U.S. airstrikes in Iraq, the U.S. air war in the country has picked up considerably, and President Obama's latest comments are laying the stage for a long-term project in the country, with further escalations likely along the way. In his interview with the New York Times, President Obama lamented the comprehensive brevity of the war in Libya, saying his decision to attack Libya and impose regime change was the right thing, but that the U.S. should have had a long follow-up mission to prop up the new government there. It is that regret that is informing his new Iraq war and his talk of a military goal of preventing the creation of an Islamic caliphate in Iraq and Syria is the only way of a protracted nation-building mission that is rapidly forming around what he presented Thursday as an emergency humanitarian intervention. Obama was quick to dismiss any talk of any time frame for a new war, saying only that it is going to take some time, and answering a question about whether that meant months or years by saying only that it wouldn't be a matter of weeks. Friday's expansion of the red lines inside Iraq to include ISIS getting near either Erbil or Baghdad were also expanded further Saturday, with Obama saying a key portion of the war now was also meant to prevent ISIS from getting a hold of key infrastructure across all of Iraq. The political goals of the war were also laid bare, with Obama promising to see Iraq's Sunni Arab minority feeling connected and well-served by a national government in the long term. Another telling aspect effect of the president's latest talk is that while he had long bragged about having gotten the U.S. out of Iraq, he openly spurned that label, insisting the pullout was not my decision and was only done because President Bush had reached a status of forces agreement which expired under his watch. Ultimately, the new Iraq war is shaping up to be even more ambitious than the 2003 misadventure, with President Obama imagining not only the ouster of ISIS from the nation's west and from Syria's east, but also the creation of a new, more inclusive Iraqi government. FPP Radio News is brought to you by Roberts & Roberts Brokerage. For over 35 years, Roberts & Roberts has been a trusted source for buying and selling your investment-grade precious metals. They now take Bitcoin for purchasing precious metals so you can turn your profits into a long-term investment. Call Roberts & Roberts today for knowledgeable advice on investing. 800-874-9760. Reuters reports, Ukrainian separatists said on Saturday that they were ready for a ceasefire with the Kiev government after increasing gains by the Ukrainian forces. Alexander Zakarchenko, prime minister of the self-proclaimed Donetsk People's Republic, said in a statement, "We are ready for a ceasefire to prevent the proliferation of a humanitarian disaster in Donbas," referring to the area of eastern Ukraine where combat is being waged. He warned that Donetsk faced a lack of food, water, and electricity, but said the rebels were ready to defend the city of around 1 million people. He added, "In the event of a storm of the city, the number of victims will increase by magnitude. We have no humanitarian corridors. There is no supply of medicines. Food supplies are nearing their end." Ukrainian officials have said they are ready to agree to a ceasefire, but only on the condition that the rebels surrender all their arms. FPP Radio News is brought to you by Coinbase. Coinbase is a simple and secure online Bitcoin wallet for sending, receiving, and storing Bitcoin. I trust Coinbase. You should too. Get started at coinbase.fppradio.com. That's coinbase.fppradio.com. Ballot Access News reports, for the first time since 1916, every statewide South Dakota state office has a minor party or independent candidate on the general election ballot. There is no minor party candidate for governor, lieutenant governor, U.S. Senate, or U.S. House, but there are independent candidates for all of those offices except for U.S. House. South Dakota makes it very difficult for a minor party member to get on his or her own party's primary ballot for statewide offices. The Socialist Party had a complete slate for all statewide offices in 1916. This has been FPP Radio News, online at fppradio.com.
It's the Onion Radio News. A spokeswoman gives birth to a spokeschild. This is Doyle Redland reporting. Tacoma spokeswoman Tammy Barker became the proud mother of a bouncing baby spokeschild last night. According to spokespeople, Barker, a spokeswoman for a Tacoma-based pharmaceutical firm, the birthing process was a major success. Peter Wahlberg, spokesman for Tammy's husband Phil, had this to say.
At 9:17 p.m. last night, an 8.5-month-old spokesfetus was delivered alive and through the miracle of birth became a 7-pound, 6-ounce spokeschild. Spokesfather and spokesmother are doing fine.
Spokeswoman Barker is expected to be released from St. Robert's Hospital tomorrow. The spokeschild will remain in the hospital's media care unit for several weeks of training. Doyle Redland for The Onion Radio News, online at theonion.com.
This is The Onion News Network.
This is Free Talk Live with me, Stephanie.
And Brian.
And Mark.
We are live here on Sunday night, kicking off hour three of tonight's program. And of course, Free Talk Live is on every single night of the week. What more could you ask for from a talk radio show? We produce content every single day, although not we, the three of us, me, Brian, and Mark, but somebody's here every night, including Ian and the rest of the Free Talk Live co-hosts, to make a show for you. And it's on from 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern Time every single night of the week. And you can call in, as always, and bring up anything that's on your mind at 855-450-3733. That's the ProXPN toll-free call-in line for you. And as we start off the third hour of tonight's show, I think we'll just go right into the calls because we got a
few. It is called Free Talk Live, after all.
Indeed. Let's talk to Keith in Michigan. Hi, Keith. You're on Free Talk Live.
Hey, Stephanie. You need to hit me up next time you're in Grand Rapids area.
Cool. I don't know when I'll be there, but I'll do
what
that.
What area?
Grand Rapids, right?
Yeah. Hey, I just wanted to touch base on what you guys were talking about earlier about, I was calling in about the inanimate objects, about kids turning them into weapons, but I'll touch subject on the when you guys were talking about people buying products from counterfeit companies as far as Gucci and all those type of products.
Yeah.
I just wanted to press the subject about people really wanting to think about what kinds of companies they're actually funding when they buy those things. I was listening to the radio earlier this week about, a lot of counterfeit people, a lot of counterfeit companies are actually funded by terrorism groups. And I'm sure not all of them are, but what you really need to think about, you know, when you buy folk leaves or Gucci type purses or products, who are you really, you know, putting your money towards?
I think you could ask the same.
Providing just as good of a service.
Well, you could ask the same question about Oakley and Gucci. I mean, like Nike and Adidas, often they're like high name brands, and they often get all kinds of crap for like their manufacturing practices. Sweatshops. Nike was like the worst with sweatshops in the 90s. That was like
right.
Spawned the whole book.
I support sweatshops personally.
You support sweatshops.
Sweatshop is a disparaging term.
Uh-huh.
And what a sweatshop is a place where somebody goes to work, which is the best place that they can find to work at a time. And I personally do not want to take away their opportunity to get to find the best job they can.
What, Keith, go ahead. What were you saying?
I was going to say, and by somebody, you mean a 7-year-old kid? Is that what you mean?
Well, I don't know if it's a 7-year-old kid, but I think that in some cases you're talking about adults. But okay, let's talk about 7-year-old kids. I had a job at 12. I mean...
Okay, but that was by your own choice. I don't think they're really being...
When you're in poorer countries, your choices are diminished. I don't think anybody should be, instituted in slavery. No, but...
I'm with you, Keith. I mean, those conditions are very similar to... They're deplorable. I mean, they're just not good. There's health risks and, you know, just work conditions that an American would never dream of undertaking. However, it's really hard to know where everything you buy comes from. Like, you could really spend a lot of time and effort just looking into the practices of every single thing you buy.
But do you understand how, if you deplore sweatshops, you make third world countries like Bangladesh poorer, not richer? Like, those people there aren't going to have... The reason they go to work at sweatshops
is... I support micro-lending, people spending their own,
They won't have a job if they to pay you back.
I think we need to understand that making them poorer is okay if we're making the people more happy. If we're making the quality of life less than what it is, if they're going to be working in sweatshops at 7 years old, then I think they deserve to be a little more happier living than being sad working at 7 years old doing shitty work.
You can't say that word, Keith.
We got to dump you. Thanks for the call.
Okay, so yeah. I didn't like at 7 years old going to school either. There's lots of things that we don't like. The conditions in foreign countries tend to stink, and you're not going to make them better by wishing that they would be better.
Mm-hmm.
So the best way to make them better, consider that 7-year-olds worked here in the United States in the past, and that's one of the reasons why we have a mature, developed economy on the world stage today is because, 7-year-olds worked. I'm not saying that I support or don't support 7-year-olds working. I think that, my son's 6 and I try to get him to work. Now, under what conditions? I don't think that an army of 7-year-olds is very good labor, frankly. And I don't know. I haven't seen any pictures of these 7-year-olds hard at work, but I assume if they are working, they're working for a reason, which is to have a better life for themselves. I don't know really what else to say.
I feel like it sounds like a choice of the lesser of two evils. But that's, again, as we always say on this show, you're still choosing like an evil. Because that's inferring that for a third world country to get to, say, a first world status, and even assuming that first world status is somehow superior, because I think what the caller was kind of saying was an interesting point, because there is a difference between the standard of living and the quality of life. They are not equitable. They don't, you know, they're not the same. One can be higher and the other can be significantly lower. The standard of living can be very high and your quality of life could suck, you know. And so if it takes a country to go through the Industrial Revolution and the working conditions of the Industrial Revolution to get to a first world status, I think there's a problem with the system than there is with the fact that a country's poor.
Well, I would love to see this way.
Yeah, I don't know it. I admit it. I don't know it.
Can step in and go from Haiti to Finland in the course of a year, but I haven't seen that happen. What I have seen happen in my lifetime was made in Japan meant junk when I was a kid.
Mm-hmm.
And now it means the best computer, you know.
It's a symbol of absolute quality.
It's where intellectual property around computers comes out of. Like, nothing's even made in Japan anymore. It's made in China, which at the time was, what it meant to me was starving kids live there. So in the course of my short, consider that the Industrial Revolution took a long time, and that trail has been blazed, and now your country in the course of two decades can go from dirt poverty. If you have the right laws and the right ways that companies can come in, your people can be exploited into a better life in 20 years. Do you want that for yourself? Do you want that for them?
Well, I think we need to remember that the reason that people are dirt poor is because of oppressive governments, and that may be the bigger fish to fry here.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like, that why don't we focus on getting rid of the state, and then economic growth will happen at a rapid pace.
I love the idea, but the state isn't going away as a concept. It was the killingest thing in the 20th century. It's extraordinarily powerful as a concept, which is to say a large monopolistic top-down government hierarchy.
Yeah, but if we're talking about it, us talking about ending the state is going to have as much influence as us talking about ending sweatshops, maybe more, you know.
If you want to end sweatshops, you need to open up the borders. Because a lot of people that want to end sweatshops, what they want to do is they want to see labor in America, and they want to close up the borders so that people can't cross over here and have better life for themselves.
They don't want to pay $20 for a pair of underwear, though. Yeah.
But you do understand that if we open up the borders and we do away with things like minimum wage laws, that you're going to have people here in this country come here to work for $2 an hour to make T-shirts cheaply or whatever they do. They might have air conditioning, but I mean, you know, people, the T-shirt companies are going to go wherever they can produce T-shirts most quickly and then bring them to the United States and sell them.
Technology is a solution to this, too. Like, if we had robots making T-shirts in a factory that's really hot instead of human beings, like, yeah, that's a no-brainer. It's probably more profitable, too, because you don't have to, you know, like, worry about the conditions for robots. You can put them in a hot room cramped together.
Nah, you gotta have air conditioning for computers. But nonetheless.
But if it's profitable, it'll happen. That's the thing.
Employees are extraordinarily expensive even when they're cheap. You know, I mean, that's the thing.
Exactly. And I don't think it's really a choice between sweatshops or like subsistence farming. Like
I think today it is.
Well, what about microlending? No. I mean, that's a huge thing.
It is, but you've got to build the people you're loaning money to microlend. They microlending money to have to be able to pay it back. They have to have.
Okay, microloans have the highest repayment rate of any type of loan, and actually, like they're getting loans for the purpose of building a business, and it usually works out well. So.
Money needs to flow in. So if you live in Stephanieville, and Stephanieville has $3.50, and there's four people, and this $3.50 flows around between these four people, your economy never grows. However, in Stephanieville, if I live in Stephanieville and I suddenly start taking in laundry from, Brianberg, and then I'm bringing in a new quarter every week, then suddenly our economy is expanding from $3.50 to $3.75
to
$4.
Give us a call. Come to Marktown, 855-450 free. This is Free Talk Live.
Hi, this is Michael Dean from the Freedom Fiends Radio Show. The internet has lowered the cost barrier for a worldwide radio show to a price approaching zero. Yet there is one arena where you still need thousands of dollars to approach the audio quality of the corporate media. Doing a live spoken show with more than one host in different geographic locations. Our program, Fiend Phone, will solve that problem, and it will be given away free. Go to fiendphone.com to see what you can do to help. That's FEENPHONE.com.
In a far future universe, Earth's fleet is shattered, rife with guerrilla warfare, interspecies diplomacy, and full-scale interstellar combat. Humanity is about to face its trial by fire.
Trial by Fire, Book 2 in the Tales of the Terran Republic, sequel to the national best-selling and award-winning Fire with Fire by distinguished professor and author Charles Gannon. Get it now from Amazon through shop.freetalklive.com.
Hi, this is Mark Edge, host of Free Talk Live. We've been witnessing a meltdown of the very economic engine that powers this country. With a printing press tethered to Washington politicians, bureaucrats, and central bankers, how can we put our trust in paper money? For years, I've been buying gold and silver from Midas Resources, and you should too. Come see gold.freetalklive.com or call 877-357-9938 for a free book titled 10 Reasons to Own Gold. With Washington, D.C. delivering more debt and printed promises, common sense tells us the future of the trend is obvious. Everyone listening should visit gold.freetalklive.com or call 877-357-9938. I trust Midas Resources for my gold, silver, platinum, and you can too. Again, I want you to have this book, and it's free. It's gold.freetalklive.com or 877-357-9938. 877-357-9938.
From that romantic summer evening in 1924 when Pol Pot was conceived, to the first time someone figured out how to eat a pineapple without ripping their mouth to shreds, this week in history. 1692, five citizens were executed after being convicted during the Salem witch trials, all while dozens of witches, warlocks, and sorcerers stood by and watched the wrongly accused take the rap for them, while a perfectly normal humans charged with witchcraft were publicly hung and dragged to their unmarked graves, the numerous Salem citizens that did spend their evenings casting spells and awakening the dead merely lowered their heads as their friends and neighbors were burned at the stake.
Historical records have indicated that as many as 35% of the people in Salem were actually witches and warlocks. In fact, the executioner himself was a well-known necromancer who, after hanging the wrongly accused witches, reanimated their dead bodies and apologized before casting them into the eternal fires of hell.
This is the Onion News Network.
If you want to know the latest about Free Talk Live before we go on the air, all you need to decide is how you want it delivered. It's your choice. Visit news.freetalklive.com. You can get emailed announcements and participate in contests via our email updates list. Plus, we have a Twitter account that you can follow and a Facebook page where you can become a fan. So visit news.freetalklive.com to get news about Free Talk Live as soon as it's announced and the way you want it delivered at news.freetalklive.com. That's news.freetalklive.com.
Are you tired of governments murdering people around the world? Stop using their money. There is an alternative. Bitcoin is a stateless, free market, non-political currency. Bitcoin cannot be inflated or controlled by any government. By using their money, you are helping the state. Stop doing it. You have an incredible alternative available now. Learn it, use it, spread it. Get started with Bitcoin at weusecoins.com. That's weusecoins.com.
You can sign up to receive the latest about the Liberty Radio Network via our email updates at updates.lrn.fm. That's updates.lrn.fm.
This is Free Talk Live, the live Sunday night show. Oh, it's been an exciting program so far, full of conflict and controversy with me, Stephanie.
And Brian.
And Mark.
Always fighting about something. No, not really. We're really the best of pals.
Even if we disagree.
Even if we disagree.
That's
about
right.
Sweatshops or intellectual property or whatever. And you can call us if you have thoughts on any of those issues at 855-450-3733. Bring up anything that's on your mind. That's why we call it Free Talk Live.
And if you're having an issue with focus or feeling fatigued, looking for the extra edge, not Mark Edge. You want to go to modup.net.
That's M-O-D. That's going to cost you way more.
Yeah. He'll do anything for charity, folks.
He
He's like Bob Hope.
He doesn't have a coupon code.
I'm telling you. But go to modup.net, M-O-D-U-P.net. Studies show one in five students use this as a cognitive enhancer all around the world. Business people all around the world are using this. Very, very popular tablets. Modafinil, which is what modup.net offers. Now, to prove the point that they're delivering the goods, the modafinil that they offer, it is of the highest potency, and they are the number one sponsor of Reddit's third-party nootropic testing project.
Can now, you go to Reddit and like read the results of that or see how it's going?
I would assume.
Yeah.
I'm not much of a Redditor.
If Reddit's behind it, then you know it's good stuff, right?
Yeah, I mean, if you're the number one sponsor doing it there, I mean, that's you're putting your money where your mouth is, and that's what you, that's what more can you ask from a company? So remember, Free Talk Live, we're an international radio show. ModUp.net ships worldwide. It's your responsibility to know, you know, how, what local prescription requirements and laws apply. Make sure you look into that and look into modafinil for yourself. But if you're going to get it, head over to modup.net, and you can use the code FTL, and you'll get 10 free tablets with your order. And you can also use Bitcoin and get a 33% discount. That's right. ModUp supports the Bitcoin community and, of course, Free Talk Live, and we appreciate that. Head over to modup.net for your modafinil.
All right. And since I just Googled nootropics Reddit testing, I'm very grateful that I had my ProXPN VPN turned on for that. Anyway, let's go to Skype. We've got a couple of calls on Skype, actually. Let's talk to Nathan first. Hi, Nathan. You're on Free Talk Live.
Hello. How's everyone tonight?
Excellent.
Wonderful. What's on your mind?
Well, first, I'm surprised that Mark said that there are only four words you can't say on this show. I thought there would be seven.
Well, okay. So there's the seven dirty words, of which there really only are six, because MF-er is really just F-er, right? Mother is an acceptable word.
And CS, is that one of the words?
I'm not sure what CS is, but well, CS is just, okay. Sea sucker.
Rooster sucker.
Right. Is, you know, that's, you know, there's just another word that you, so. Yeah, you can't say the words you can't say are on as far as the FCC goes are F, S, and two C's. But Free Talk Live, we have a higher standard because we're on news talk stations. This isn't, you know, in the morning it's Mark and Stephanie. You know, it's not that kind of show. So,
radio puking.
It's just a different kind of show. So we have a higher standard. There are certainly other words that we will, you know, we would prefer not be uttered on the air.
Is that like the N-word? Because I have
Definitely the N-word is not acceptable on this show. I just won't deal with it.
I've had situations where people have called in while I was in the first chair, so I'm in control of the dump panel,
yep.
And someone has used the N-word in what I would consider a sort of a tasteful context.
Yeah,
like
I gotcha.
It was a discussion about historical racism or something, and I was unsure about what to do.
I know I won't dump them and drop them if they use it properly.
Mm-hmm.
Just, you know, dump it and then explain to them, look, this is, you know, we don't use that term here on this show.
What if they
it's
say, like,
loaded.
What up, N-word?
Yeah, I don't have any idea.
Okay.
It's never happened, well, thank God.
I think only black people are allowed to do that, Stephanie. So,
well, how can I tell over the radio?
That's the social pressure. And, you know,
you just have to guess.
My good friend Julian, we were out at a movie. He's a black man, or at least, you know, somewhat black. And a guy just kind of walks up to him, and, you know, a black guy walks up to him and says, what's up, my N-word, right? And it enraged me because he never speaks like this, and this isn't, he would never address anyone in that manner. And he's fine with it, right? But I'm like, no, you don't do that. And that's not acceptable. But, you know, whatever. I guess it's whatever it is for whoever says it, right?
I was not here last week because I was at a friend's wedding in England, actually. And I was talking to a Greek guy from England at their wedding, and he told me the story of how he had visited the U.S. once and went to Atlanta for a business trip or something like that.
Uh-huh.
Went out with one of his coworkers, and they walked into this strip club called Onyx. And what they didn't know...
sounds great.
It was a black strip club. These two white guys walk in, and it was just like... everyone looked at them and they couldn't figure out why, because they didn't understand that, you know,
right.
You know, this is really not
perhaps
a place
he wasn't
where you're
as welcome as
supposed
you
to
thought.
Go. And so he was like, yeah,
strong social pressure not to be in there.
Yeah. There's a lot of these little weird nuances. Anyway, Nathan, we're just babbling. What's on your mind?
Okay. Well, I like the Animal House reference there. That was funny. So I've been thinking about this, something that I learned or that I heard while I was taking a humanities class, and it's the claim that the most important parable in the Bible is the parable of the sower, and I disagree with that, and I was curious to hear what everyone on this show thinks is the most important parable. I guess maybe
what's the parable of the sower? I mean, I don't want to make it into Bible Talk Live, but just briefly, what is it?
Well, just briefly, there's a man who sows seeds, and it comes to pass that some fall and are immediately devoured by birds. Some are unable to take root, and when the sun comes up, they're scorched. Yeah. And then
they fall on rocky ground.
Yes, and then some fall among thorns, and the thorns grow up and choke them out. But some fall on good ground and increase up to 30, 60, and 100-fold. I'm not sure why that's not 90, but anyway. So the moral of this parable is that the word of Christ is analogous to the seed, in that some people will immediately reject it, some will accept it, but then when things get difficult, or like when they get in trouble or threatened, we'll just drop it.
Let me ask you this. Is it explained? Because I remember certainly of having heard the parable and even had these little Bible books when I was a kid.
Well, actually, Jesus explains it right afterwards.
Okay, that was my question. Does Jesus explain this?
Yeah, well, this is what he says right afterwards. So, And of course, then I think the thorns, I forget it. Oh, yeah, the thorns represent worldly desires and such things, I guess, taking up your time instead of pursuing the word of Christ or something. Anyways, it seems to me this can't really be representative of Christianity, because you can apply this to anything. You could say
it sounds like a great analogy for talking about liberty.
Yeah. You know,
that's what I was going to say. Yeah.
Right. You know, it's an interesting point, Nathan. I mean, whether or not, I guess, I don't know if value is subjective or not. I mean, for whether or not this parable is the best of the bunch. But I think you can find a lot of the things that Jesus has claimed as of saying, you can find them a good 100 years ago, or at least a few decades away, being very common in the Roman Empire in the first place. Including the Golden Rule is a very popular one. Publius Cyrus actually said that way before Jesus could have ever been born. And he was not Christian, obviously, nor was he a Jew. So a lot of these ideas, right, they could work for anything, and that's probably because they were from other sources.
Yep. Nathan? Mark?
Yeah, I've got a parable. I'll take a shot at it.
Okay, hold please. There's some more coming up here on Free Talk Live. 855-450-FREE.
This is Dan Pilla. Do you owe the IRS money you can't pay? Are tax debts crippling you? I've defended people from the IRS for over 30 years. I've helped thousands, and I can help you too. I wrote the book on IRS settlement, and I'm telling you, there's no such thing as a hopeless case. Call 800-34-NO-TAX to finally get free of IRS debt. With the IRS's new programs, there's never been a better time to solve your problem. Call 800-34-NO-TAX. That's 800-34-NO-TAX, or my website, danpilla.com.
Do you ever feel like you live in an alternate universe? As the stock market hits new highs, the middle class are dying. Manipulated financial markets and economic figures, chaos on our border, China and Russia bypassing the dollar. Life is getting ready to change. You need to prepare to thrive in the new economy. Go to babyboomerbackupplan.com or call 888-507-8789. That's 888-507-8789.
What if the key to achieving liberty in your lifetime was to move together with others who think like you? Liberty activists are joining the Free State Project, which is over 70% of the way to its goal of 20,000 participants. And they're already making the move to New Hampshire. The successes are piling up and are proving the Free State Project is a real movement and no longer just a great idea. When you're planning your move, consider Keene. Keene is famous for its civil disobedience and non-cooperation, and there's plenty of political opportunity as well. From demonstrations and vigils to outreach and volunteering, there's a lot going on in Keene. Keene is the Liberty Media capital of the world, with television, talk radio, and more, all originating here. Though it's more than just activism, with regular social events each week. See what's happening at freekeene.com and get connected with video, audio, free books, a forum, and activist tools you can download and use in your area at freekeene.com. That's freekeene.com.
Liberty activists around the country are starting to realize politics alone won't set us free. So what will? At Liberty on the Rocks, we believe the answer starts with living your principles, spreading ideas, and connecting with those around you. By starting a Liberty on the Rocks network, you can make a difference by uniting libertarian thinkers. Find out how much fun it is to build your local network from the ground up. Visit libertyontherocks.org today to get started.
Here's a chance to do a little activism while you're cruising Facebook, Twitter, or Google+. Between the LOL cats, the recipes, the hot girls, and the inspirational sunrise memes, Free Talk Live's posts pass by your newsfeed. Like them. Comment. It gives us more exposure. If you don't see our posts, click like at facebook.freetalklive.com and then hover over it to click get notifications. It's an easy way to spread the ideas of liberty a bit further. I know you're busy, but you can spare that tenth of a calorie it takes to click on something. facebook.freetalklive.com.
A meme is not easy to define.
What is it?
But you know it when you see it.
Amazing.
Don'tTreadOnMeme.com proves that.
I feel so enlightened.
Don't Tread on Meme, M-E-M-E, helping you give the finger to our monetary system of deception by providing you with silver dime trading cards. Unlike today's dollar, they have value, and they look neat too.
Well, would you look at those? Aren't those just swell?
Don'tTreadOnMeme.com. While you're browsing their numerous silver dime card designs, take time to download the easy-to-use Silver Calculator app. This simple piece of technology lets you know instantly, whether using iPhone or Android, just how much your silver coin is worth. Find out all the details at Don'tTreadOnMeme.com. Now accepting Bitcoin. Don't Tread on Meme, your path to a voluntary society with honest money. Don'tTreadOnMeme.com, serving you faster than the Fed prints money.
What's up next? Visit the Liberty Radio Network program guide to find out at shows.lrn.fm. That's shows.lrn.fm.
This is Free Talk Live. It's the live Sunday night show with me, Stephanie.
And Brian.
And Mark.
And you can call us at 855-450-3733. Bring up anything that's on your mind. Our website, of course, freetalklive.com, where we give away archives of our shows for free. Free Talk Live has been on the air for many, many thousands of hours. And you can find archives, you know, pick a year, pick your favorite season of Free Talk Live, and it's all there for you at archives.freetalklive.com for free, organized by year and with the little topic descriptions on each show.
Expresscoin.com. If you want to get some bitcoins or other cryptocurrencies, you can do it through expresscoin.com. They've got Bitcoin, Dogecoin, Litecoin, Blackcoin, Darkcoin.
Blackcoin. Woo.
You're liking Blackcoin today?
Yeah. Yeah, I like Blackcoin.
Well, if Brian says it, then it's there you go. It's your Blackcoin outlet, expresscoin.com. They're completely legal there. I just wanted to make that clear. They're a licensed money services business. They're easy, fast, safe, inexpensive. As a matter of fact, if you use coupon code FTL, you can get up to $40 worth of your favorite cryptocurrency, be it Blackcoin or Bitcoin, for no fee at all. So that's coupon code FTL at expresscoin.com. Yes, they are available in Canada. You can even do it from your smartphone by downloading the app at expresscoin.com. Again, expresscoin.com, coupon code FTL.
Such wow.
Yep, that's the Dogecoin reference there.
Had to throw that in. Okay, so we are sowing the seeds of liberty with this discussion with Nathan. Let's bring you back on the line here,
I like
Nathan.
To spill the seed of liberty myself.
I know, God, you do.
I bet you do.
Brian actually did not make that up. So one of his listeners did.
Funny. Yeah.
The sovereign techies. Anyway,
actually,
Nathan.
There's another verse that says that's a sin, so...
That's in Genesis.
Right. So we were talking about the parable of the sower, where it's basically about spreading ideas. Like, when you spread ideas, you have to kind of cast a wide net, put them out there, and some people will gravitate to them and maybe take them up themselves and spread them further. Some people will reject them outright. Some people will kind of accept them, but then, like, leave when the going gets tough and so forth. So... Why did you say you think this is the most important story in the Bible, Nathan?
Oh, I was going to say it's not the most important story because because it's like you say it's a very universal message. You can apply it to a lot of things. I mean, like Brian was saying, you could apply it to the liberty movement, but in this case, he's trying to apply it to Christianity. But you could apply it to a lot of things. It just doesn't really seem emblematic to me of what Christianity is. So that's why I was curious what Brian and Mark and I don't know if you're that interested in this discussion, but I was curious what they thought was the most representative parable, like the one
I'll
you
leave
think
it
of
to the
when
Bible
you think
geeks.
Of Christianity.
Yeah, well, so I mean, you had some professors say that the most important parable in the Bible was the parable of the sower, and that's fine. I don't know what important means. Important
well,
means
that's whatever. What I'm that's what I mean, like most representative of Jesus's teachings.
Yeah, I would say that I don't know representative, but I you asked me important, so I had a, I had something prepared. I don't know what representative Jesus. I have no clue.
Go ahead.
I think Jesus is probably a conglomeration of some very interesting teachers, you know, Jewish teachers. That's what my guess is. But he may, because I mean, certainly some of the things that happened with Jesus happened, you know, to Osiris and a bunch of other fictitious people, but. For me, the most important is the parable of Lazarus, the rich man and Lazarus. Lazarus and the rich man.
I was going to say this is the worst. This is the one that turns Christianity into like an evil religion, in my opinion.
Well, one thing about the parable of Lazarus and the rich man is that they, you know, like the rich man walks past Lazarus, doesn't give him alms or something like that, and then or knows him, I guess is what it's said. And then they go to the afterlife, and the rich man is in something akin to hell, although it's never called that, and Lazarus is in paradise, although it's never called heaven.
It's called Abraham's bosom.
Abraham's bosom, I guess is what it's called, yes. And
he's got bosoms?
Well, I mean, we all have a bosom. Yours is just
it shows
much
how ridiculous the parable is.
And that, you know, he then begs the Lazarus for just a drop of water on his tongue. What's interesting, though, is that at no point do they ever say the sin that the rich man committed, nor do they say, you know, they're completely unclear as to why he's in hell.
Well, he's a rich man. It's easier for a person to go through the eye of a needle than a rich man.
They certainly say that. Easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle. Then you're not sure what an eye of a needle is. Is it that little door in the big door at a temple gate? We don't know.
Right along the wall. Yeah.
Right. We don't know what it is, but the suggestion is that basically being rich ends you up in hell. But then it's really the only good reference to hell in the whole, that people in hell, actual individual human beings in hell, in the whole New Testament. So it sort of legitimizes the story of hell,
exactly.
But never even says God in his holy word, never even explains why he puts this person in hell. So I don't know what the story is supposed to mean. There's all kinds of you know, philosophies. I enjoy the preterists and what they have to say on it. But, you know, you're like, does hell exist? And what's important about it is that it creates hell as a legitimate concept in Christianity.
Yeah.
When hell is really iffy in the Bible.
Yeah, I would think without this parable, you wouldn't have a case for the eternal hellfire and all that business. It just wouldn't be there.
Right. Hell was created for demons. That, you know, that's where, or excuse me, God's angels that somehow, the third of God's angels that Lucifer takes with him, but God controls Lucifer. I don't know what that story is. It's baffling to me. But hell's was created for them, not for people, according to the story.
Wasn't there a passage about unbelievers will be cast into Gehenna or something?
There's the lake of fire at the end. Gehenna is actually, Gehenna's used, that's actually the garbage pit that existed outside of Jerusalem. Yeah.
Speaking of hell, I think we're in radio hell. So Nathan, thank you for the call. We're going to move on. Appreciate your thoughts tonight. Let's talk to Dan listening in Connecticut. Hi, Dan. You're on Free Talk Live. What's on your mind?
Oh, hey, guys. Thanks for taking my call.
Sure thing.
I'm kind of a new listener to you guys and trying to kind of make sense of what would the free state look like if we could institute it in a day? Who would take care of the roads? Would there be taxes? Would we have a hospital? I mean,
in my world, there would not be any taxes. There would be hospitals that people could go to if they needed help.
Well, it's important to bring up, like initially, that the first hospitals in the world, as well as in the U.S., were founded by often Catholics, were founded by religions, not by governments by any stretch.
Yeah, and often roads were also independent. Yeah. People would kind of pay into, it basically was health insurance, but done like mutual aid. So you'd pay a couple bucks a month and there'd be a doctor on call for everybody kind of thing.
It's a question that's going to have a bunch of different answers, no doubt.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think roads would probably
have, you know, your established political parties, then they kind of teeter back. They're not too different from each other, but they kind of find some equilibrium that they can exist at. And when I listen to the show and I hear different viewpoints and listen to different podcasts and the black sheep and all this stuff is that there's a wide variation between everybody's feeling of what that would look like. And given that there are other countries which are statist, wouldn't we just get overrun?
Okay, I think that this is really excellent. Probably the single best argument against a free enclave, a free place, because free state kind of is, it's the Free State Project from freestateproject.org. But, a free place might very well be overrun by a place that's, a tyrannical country who puts all their efforts into militarization, a la North Korea or the Soviet Union. Like, these organizations did a very good job of sort of ramping up their military and probably would have...
How about the U.S.?
Well, the U.S. creates puppet states, and they wouldn't... It's not quite as...
No, they still occupy places, but... Yeah, anyway, Dan, if you would, hold the line for a minute. I'd like to continue this discussion. I mean, nobody really knows what a free society would like. Everybody would look like. Everybody has their guesses and their little pet ideas about what it would be like. I can say that I don't know what it would look like either, but... I know that it wouldn't involve force, and that's what I'm most interested in. What about you? 855-450-3733 is our number here on Free Talk Live, the Sunday show. Final segment coming up.
Wake up and smell the freedom. One of the easiest things you can do to help Liberty is to torrent Freedom Fiends episodes to help keep them drone-proof. You can set up your home computer to download and share Freedom Fiends archives over BitTorrent. You can even set up scheduling so it only shares while you're asleep or at work. Put your unused computing power to work and help keep the Freedom Fiends around well into the future. Simply go to freedomfiends.com and click on the Torrent Club link and learn how to torrent and share Freedom Fiends archives.
Are you searching for your soulmate? Someone you can trust who will never betray you or cooperate with the NSA? Stop searching. With EasyDNS, you found a keeper. EasyDNS does it all. Domain names, web hosting, and managed WordPress hosting. EasyDNS stands up for your internet freedom. And with servers in Canada, they do not cooperate with the NSA. Go to EasyDNS.com. You'll love their services or get a full refund. They guarantee it. And they accept Bitcoin. That's EasyDNS.com.
At 30dayfoodsupply.com, you can now purchase a one-of-a-kind product not available anywhere else, a meatless burger dry mix in four delicious flavors. With our new Oregon Trail Foods vegan burgers, all you do is add water and fry. They need no refrigeration. They're packaged in Mylar bags with an oxygen absorber for a long shelf life. They're non-GMO. They're gluten, soy, nut, and chemical-free, but they're loaded with flavor and a good source of carbs and protein, yet low in sodium. Flavors include Italian, spicy Mexican, six vegetable, and black bean olive. Go to 30dayfoodsupply.com or call 541-229-0010 and order today. Eat them every day, take them camping, or save them for an emergency. Check them out at 30dayfoodsupply.com and click on the vegan burger icon. That's 30dayfoodsupply.com, where all of our products are produced in Oregon by Oregon Trail Foods. 30dayfoodsupply.com.
Since time began, tyrants have taken aim at personal liberties. Now there's a movie that aims back.
The government has no more right to tell us what to put in our bodies than they have to take our guns or tell us what books we can read.
Six drug police were eaten by bears while raiding a marijuana farm.
On your knees, you dirty hippies! Jesus. On your knees!
What's the problem, officer?
Today, many cops who enforce pot laws do so only because it provides them with cushy jobs, good benefits, and a chance to push people around.
I was an undercover narcotics officer. The drug war is nothing but a farce.
The Second Amendment says you gotta keep you and your gat intact.
Guns and Weed, the Road to Freedom. A film by Michael W. Dean and Nima Vadavi.
DVD available now at gunsandweed.com or on Amazon. That's gunsandweed.com. Makes the perfect gift. Remember, that's gunsandweed.com.
So you've heard all 3 hours of the latest episode of Free Talk Live, and you're still hungry for liberty-oriented audio content? Did you know that we have another 24/7 audio stream at LRN.fm? The Liberty Radio Network airs the latest episodes of some of the best liberty-oriented podcasts on the internet, around the clock. In addition to recorded content, you'll also hear live shows like Free Talk Live, originating from our Keene, New Hampshire studio. So listen anytime at LRN.fm. That's LRN.fm.
Shiny badges on your jacket. Shiny badges.
This is Davi Barker from ShinyBadges.com, and I just want to personally apologize for airing a jingle week after week, month after month, that turned out to be such an infectious brain worm. So to make it up to you, I'm offering a free gift. The next time you make a purchase at ShinyBadges.com, write WORMS in the transaction comments, and I'll send you something weird.
If you enjoy LRN.fm, please contribute to your favorite shows via their websites and become an amplifier at amp.lrn.fm. That's amp.lrn.fm.
This is Free Talk Live, the live Sunday night edition, and we are kicking off the final segment of tonight's show. There might be still... I don't think I'm even going to give the phone number out because we're kind of loaded up, so... If you want to call it, maybe best to do it tomorrow night. Free Talk Live is on 7 nights a week. And we've also got podcast archives posted on our website, which is freetalklive.com. With you tonight, it's me, Stephanie.
And Brian.
And Mark.
And just want to take a quick minute out to let you know, we all have some sort of side projects, don't we? Mark has a podcast. It's called The Edgington Post. He interviews interesting people.
I particularly enjoyed your interview with Ben Bova.
It was fantastic. It was awesome.
Yeah. Great thoughts.
Yep, and you can access that on freetalklive.com. You subscribe to Mark's podcast. Brian also has a podcast called Sovereign Tech, SOVRYNTech.com is your website. You do a weekly technology show, and it is fun. I mean, your podcast is just fun to listen to. I never miss a show.
I can get a little heated, but it is fun.
And I am a voice actor, and if you want to check out my voice work, you can go to smvoice.info and hire me for your next voiceover project if you so desire, if you're so inclined. Let's go right back to Dan in Connecticut. Now, Dan, we were kind of talking about your vision or different visions for a free society.
Yeah.
And Mark had some thoughts.
One of the difficulty things here, Dan, is you've sort of thrown out my roads and the hospitals and, foreign countries invading and all these things. And these are a lot of issues. There's very big issues in the liberty world. I'd love to talk to you.
Maybe we could just go to one.
That's what I want to do.
We have the immigration thing down on the border, or lack thereof, and how do you guys see that playing out?
So immigration, remember, the problems have been created by the political process being in play up to this point. So
we all agree on that.
We agree on that. So I say that what we need to do is we need to let hardworking people, intelligent people, come into this country and build things that are better for all of us. That would be a really awesome thing. And so I recommend immediately cut all forms of welfare, things that promote sloth, and allow people to come here and build a better life for themselves and their families immediately. That'll put pressure on neighboring nations, specifically nations like Canada and Mexico and Central American nations. If their citizenry is coming to the United States in order to have a better life for themselves, they're going to have to create a better government very, very quickly.
Okay. I get that, but are you so advocating for no border at all and people just freely come and go?
At this point, you almost have no border at all. There are tens of millions of people in this country illegally that are essentially working as serfs because they can't change jobs because they're this second-class citizen. I mean, at this point, the border practically doesn't exist.
Yeah, it's always important to look at what we've got now.
And the other choice is, like building a lake of fire between us and Mexico and, radioactive machine guns or whatever the hell people are going to put up there to keep out the people that want to build a better life for themselves.
Well, in my particular situation, I worked in high-level democratic politics, and I've been a business owner, and I left that, and I became successful in the construction business, and as the state, the democratic state here in Connecticut, piled on the regulations and the policies and the fees and the stuff like that. It got heavier and heavier and heavier. And as we had an influx of immigrants who were coming in and working under the table for other business people, I worked alongside them on jobs. But when the crash came, it was impossible to compete with firms using labor that was so much cheaper. I would lose jobs, mm-hmm. and subsequently, I have not been able to rekindle that.
Yeah, and look at the immigrant. That's a problem of the immigration, situation. Mm-hmm. If in my world, you would be free to hire high skilled, people that have come here for a better life for themselves, have moved mm-hmm. here, and that wouldn't be a problem.
Yeah, Dan. Yeah,
have you guys seen that letter that gets circulated around where they have Juan illegal
yes.
and John legal?
Yes, and they compare, them having a job making, one guy makes $15
yeah, exactly.
an hour legally, the other guy makes $8 illegally, and then they show how much more money you make with $8 illegally.
Then
I felt
the
that it's somewhat.
Guy at the end still has the same amount of money because he's been taking all the welfare, and
yep.
the guy who's been working has to take a second job, and he's totally broke.
Yep, I've seen it. And
yeah.
I think it's, it's a mess, but I think that if you put out a bowl of cat food every single morning on your front doorstep, and then you scream and rail about how stray cats come and eat your cat food, you're a fool.
I agree.
Dan, I would love to talk to you more about this, maybe save these issues and call in. Sometimes the beginning of the show is less crowded
yeah,
for calls.
I'd love to. Is there an email I can send to?
We don't really read emails.
It's
on
free
the,
talk live.
Yeah, on the air. On the air.
I would say, if you knew my background, I think you guys would find it fascinating.
I find it fascinating already,
you
said on the air.
You can email Mark at freetalklive.com or just call in any night of the week between 7 and 10 p.m. And thank you so much for the call, Dan, tonight. Let's quickly go to Aaron listening on Skype. Hey, Aaron, you're on Free Talk Live. What's on your mind?
Hey, I just wanted to call in real quick. The thing I heard about intellectual property earlier makes me think of people I get this conversation with often feel like small inventors are benefited by intellectual property, that if they don't have this IP, then the big guys are going to steamroll them.
Yeah, I think that's accurate.
That's how they feel.
It's accurate that is how they feel. Mm-hmm.
Right. But if we didn't have intellectual property, I think the workers in Bangladesh, the sweatshops, could use the skills if the conditions became too bad, they could learn how to make a Gucci bag and then go somewhere else and make a Gucci bag and start competing with the larger companies.
Mm.
Fascinating. Yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah, that is an interesting tie-in. Is that all you had to say?
There's also another example. Brian mentioned on Sovereign Tech about Candy Swipe versus Candy Crush. The original maker of the game Candy Crush essentially got steamrolled by Candy Swipe he made, and then Candy Crush steamrolled them, and then went out and bought Candy Crusher so they could use the government to bludgeon this guy out of business when there's plenty of business for both of them.
Yeah, IP actually hurt this guy. It hurt the original creator.
Oh,
IP
so
destroyed
this
him.
This is the popular game.
Yeah, Candy Crush. Mm-hmm. Originally, it was created by somebody else, and it was called Candy Swipe.
Huh.
And this guy, he got screwed by the IP system.
So wait, what? Can you explain again what happened? Brian?
I'm trying to, let me think exactly how it went down. It's been a while since I talked about it, but Aaron obviously listened to it recently. Aaron, could you describe it a little better?
Yeah, there's a guy who made a game, Candy Crush, or Candy Swipe, in honor of his dead mother, I guess. And,
right.
And it was the first game he made. It was bread and butter. It was what was supporting his family. Well, then Candy Crush, I guess, came along and basically knocked off his idea. And then when he went to try and make a stink about it and get a settlement or something like, hey, either buy out my IP or do something else, they went and bought this other company, Candy Crusher, in order to have this argument in court, the same one that he had. Basically, he was knocking off their idea that he was the... So now they owned the other intellectual property to say that this guy couldn't use it, I guess.
So the first guy didn't patent or his game that he made, another company ripped it off, patented it, and then sued the first guy, basically?
It wasn't about the patent of the game. They couldn't patent the software exactly. They changed
copyright.
It up enough. It mm-hmm. was the name, yeah, the copyright.
Oh, it was the
trademark.
Name. Wow, yeah. that's an interesting story.
Yeah, I mean, the sword of IP swings both ways. I think it's a great point.
Yeah, IP, is all anybody has to do is look at this. If you think IP protects the little guy, Really? Where else in the political system, in the judicial system, is the little guy protected?
This is
how big companies get you. They pretend like they're protecting little people. Look, IP doesn't protect little people. Maybe one out of 20 times it protects the little guy. But the other times, it's used as a cudgel to smash the little guy's skull open. Mm. That's what IP's for. IP is so that big, powerful companies can employ big, powerful lawyers to stop innovation, destroy new ideas, make things more expensive. That's all it's about. It's about destroying productivity. It's about making this making it harder for the individual to have a better life.
I just recently heard. Did you guys hear about this patent troll that was trying to sue popular podcasters because they were claiming that they
they own podcasting.
Yeah, they they claimed that they had some kind of patent on podcasting.
But Adam Carolla. They sued him, and then he's trying to make sure that he won't let them unsue him.
Right.
They're trying to drop the case, but he won't let them.
Yeah, exactly, because he wants
God bless
to just
Adam Carolla.
Prove that it's BS, right?
Right.
Yeah.
It also stifles innovation, I think. With you could have these small innovations, like with rifling and such, that you can't have if you have IP. No one could make a new phone from scratch, but they could maybe make a small innovation to an iPhone. Mm.
Good points, Aaron, tonight. Yeah, thank you for calling in. We're out of time. This has been Free Talk Live. Our website, freetalklive.com. Check back a little later tonight for the archives of the show, and have a great week. We'll see you next time.
Why did you move to the Shire?
I moved here to the Shire because there's other people around who take liberty just as seriously as I do.
I moved to the Shire because I saw videos of people challenging authority and thought that I could get support myself. It called to me, do this right now.
I wanted to be around people like me who got it. And once I got here, I knew there was nowhere else that I wanted to be.
I've always wanted to change the world. So I moved to the Shire to join people who were actually working towards doing the same thing.
The people here are awesome, loving, and positive. It was for the adventure and for